They'll be right up. I'm going to start with my opening remarks. Simca's here. Simca, come on in. I'm joined by Senator Mike Nozzolio, Senator Simca Felder, who's part of our task force. And here comes our chairman now, Phil Boyle, who is the chairman of, and with my co-host here, Simca Felder. So I'll be turning this over to you. Open up, sir.
Thank you, Senator Golden, and thank you, Senator Simca Felder, for co-hosting this forum, and Senator Nozzolio, thank you for joining us. This is the ninth of 17 forums around the state we're holding as part of this heroin and opioid task force. The mission of the task force is to have a report due about June 1st, and then subsequent legislation before session ends this year to combat this statewide epidemic. We've gotten some great testimony and feedback interaction over the last several of our forums, and we look forward to hearing from our witnesses today and getting some good ideas. Obviously, as Senator Golden probably mentioned, we're focusing on prevention, treatment, and law enforcement. So any of you, if you do your expertise, whether it's in any of those areas, thinking outside the box, what has worked, what do you not think will work, and if you ever thought there ought to be a law, this is the time to talk about it. So thank you, and I appreciate being here. Thank you.
Senator,
I just want to thank Senator Golden for hosting this event and being gracious enough to include my name.
Just my comments briefly. It's wonderful to be with all my colleagues, especially the two of them from New York City, Senator Golden, Senator Felder. Thank you for your attention to this issue. What we're finding is that the epidemic of heroin is not exclusive to the inner cities anymore. Certainly, we're in the biggest city and in our state, but today we want to hear your experiences. But the task force is finding this is an issue now, small cities, suburbs, rural areas. It's pervasive across the state. So thank you very much for your testimony. Without further ado, Chairman, thank you.
I want to thank again our chairman and our co-chairman and, of course, Mike Nozzolio for coming and being part of this task force today. I just want to point out three paragraphs here that are important, and then we're going to open up. In February this year, New York Times reported that the Federal Drug Enforcement Administration heroin seizures in New York State increased 67% over the last 4 years, seizing 144 kilograms of heroin, 20% of seizures nationwide, valued at $43 million. My colleague Simca is from Brooklyn, and myself, Southwest Brooklyn, is unfortunate. A number of people have lost their lives, have been hospitalized, and currently addicted to prescription drugs, heroin, and more. We're going to hear from some of the people from Southwest Brooklyn who just had another death there last week and an overdose of heroin. Today's Daily News, you see an actress in England. They just came up. She had overdosed in early April, and they're saying that now is a heroin overdose as well. According to the New York City Department of Health, 84 Brooklyn residents, 84, died unintentional overdoses involving heroin in 2012, 26 more than 2011. What we've been able to do in the state of New York is to address ISTOP on the opiates, on the prescription drugs, OxyContin. And in 2011, there were 22 million painkiller prescriptions written in New York State in the homes of 20 million people. Think about the numbers. Those are astounding. But we did so good on ISTOP in bringing those prescription drug overdoses down. Still, there's a significant number of opiate deaths out there by pill. But I will tell you that they went, the water raised itself and to the level, and heroin has come in and picked up that area. And you can pick up a deck of heroin today, $3, $5, $7, $8. And you can have hundreds of decks of heroin on you, and it's not a felony here in the state of New York. It should be. And we're going to listen to testimony, as my good colleague has said, on all areas, not only on the arrest and conviction and jail time for the people that are selling this drugs, and as well as those for treatment and prevention as well. So I want to thank you all for being so patient here today, and I turn this back over to my colleague, Senator Boyle.
Thank you, Senator. And we have our initial panel. Just briefly introduce yourself and then where you're from for the record. Sir?
Sorry, doctor? I'm Bradford Goff. I'm chairman of psychiatry at Lutheran Medical Center in Brooklyn.
Thank you.
You're going to use the mic, doctor.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Bradford Goff. I'm chairman of psychiatry at Lutheran Medical Center in Brooklyn.
My name is Andrew Klodny. I'm the chief medical officer of the Phoenix House Foundation, a national nonprofit addiction treatment agency located in Brooklyn throughout New York State and in different parts of the country. I'm also the president of Physicians for Responsible Opioid Prescribing, which is a national organization representing doctors in the fields of pain, addiction, primary care, public health, emergency medicine, and other specialties.
My name is Henry Bartlett. I'm the executive director of COMPA, and we're the provider coalition in New York State that represents those treatment programs that use addiction medicine as part of the comprehensive treatment of opioid dependence.
Good morning. I'm Dr. Hillary Cunnins. I'm the acting executive deputy commissioner for mental hygiene at the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene.
Now, the way, and thank you very much, all of you, for coming and agreeing to take time out of your schedule to be here. We like to be a little more informal about this. It's not a technical hearing. It's a forum. And so if we could just ask questions, if any of my colleagues obviously want to chime in or any of you want to answer a question that might have been directed to somebody else, please feel free. We're trying to get as much information as possible. Dr. Klodny, I'd just like to start with you. You're a part of an organization that looks at prescription and overprescribing, perhaps. A lot of people feel that the current heroin crisis is a result of the ICE-STOP legislation, perhaps, or an exacerbating factor of the heroin situation, I should say. A couple years ago, we passed the ICE-STOP legislation, which cut down on prescription overprescribing, and pharmacy and doctors included, which may have led us to go toward some of the addicts to go towards heroin. Can you give me an example of how you feel about that, or do you think that's where we're looking at?
Yeah, I think there's a half-truth mixed in there. The explanation for the rising use of heroin in, across New York State, especially in suburban and rural counties, is actually very easy to find if you speak to a new heroin user, someone who's become addicted to heroin over the past decade, and this is an individual who's very likely to be white and between the ages of 20 and 35. What they will tell you is that their addiction, the reason that they were using heroin is that they became addicted to opioids. Mm-hmm. And that addiction began through use of painkillers, and they switched to heroin because heroin was easier to access. This trend of people switching, getting addicted to painkillers and then moving to heroin has been going on for the past decade. This is not something that just happened overnight in the context of ICE-STOP.
Okay. And to what? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Sorry to jump in, but I just want to add to what Dr. Klodny mentioned in about New York City data. We know in New York City that heroin overdoses began to rise from 2010 to 2011, which predates ICE-STOP and predates many of our New York City efforts around promoting more judicious opioid prescribing.
On that point, the demographic that Dr. presented is a demographic that has gone through a prevention education process for most of their school lives in this state. The DARE program across New York, the anti-drug programs, how did there becomes such a disconnect for that generation or that age group that you mentioned, Doctor?
When we talk about opioids, we're talking about painkillers and heroin, and drugs like Vicodin and Percocet are essentially heroin pills. The active ingredient in those medications is almost identical to heroin. The effects are indistinguishable. It doesn't mean we shouldn't prescribe them because they're essentially heroin pills, but we should prescribe them very cautiously. They're good for end-of-life care or for short-term use. The young people who are becoming addicted to opioids through use of painkillers are not really aware, I believe, that they are using a drug very similar to heroin. It's not until they're really addicted that they begin to figure out that it's essentially the same thing as heroin. Many of us may have experimented with drugs when we were young, and many of us may have made a distinction in our mind what a soft drug was, maybe marijuana, and what a hard drug was, and we would have known to stay away from heroin. The young people who have become addicted, who are now using heroin, when painkillers came along, to them they were a soft drug. They came out of mom's medicine chest. They were prescribed by a doctor. They were not cut with anything. They didn't realize they were playing with fire.
It snuck up on them, in effect, an addiction that was never meant to happen, but happened.
Correct.
Senator Boyle mentioned three important components of this task force, and your thoughts on prevention and treatment, particularly from this panel, would be very helpful.
Well,
Mr. Bartlett, did you?
Yeah, I thank you for the opportunity to be here. I want to talk about two things very briefly. One is prevention of overdose, and then second is treatment. I know that Senator Boyle has been very active in promoting overdose prevention, doing trainings, making sure that folks have access to an overdose prevention kit like this. I was in a meeting on Tuesday in Washington where SAMHSA is going to make a lot more of these available. They're trying to make a lot more of these available to the treatment programs in New York, and we're going to play an active role in doing training and handing out these kits. We've already done that in conjunction with the Harm Reduction Coalition and Vocal New York, but clearly a lot more needs to be done. Secondly, I just want to talk a little bit about the evidence base of treating opiate addiction. There's a lot that's going on in the name of treating opiate addiction. Some of it's evidence-based and some of it is not. And I brought three reports for you folks on the panel, the first of which is the NIH consensus statement that was written 14 years ago, which talks about the use of, 17 years ago, which talks about the use of addiction medicine as part of a comprehensive approach to treatment, including counseling and wraparound services. And the NIH consensus panel all that time ago concluded that far and away the most effective way of dealing with chronic long-term opiate addiction was to use an addiction medicine along with counseling and wraparound services. What's interesting is that in the 17 years since this has been published, really hasn't been any major contradictions to this. And I want to talk about what I mean when I say evidence. I mean peer-reviewed outcome studies subject to the rigors of academia published in scholarly journals. That ought to be the basis for where we decide to expand our treatment of this epidemic. And there, the other two reports that are much more recent, these were published in November of 2013 by SAMHSA. One talks about the efficacy of methadone treatment, the other about the efficacy of buprenorphine treatment. What's interesting about all of these is that they support one another, and each of these cite multiple previous studies that have been done. So I want to encourage us to think about, as we move forward with treatment, that if additional resources are made available, and we certainly hope they will be, that the resources are spent in a way that it promotes evidence-based care, where we have the highest likelihood of achieving a positive outcome for these newly addicted folks.
If you could expand on that,
what type of dollars and what type of, where would that money be spent?
Well, I think that there are a number of venues where addiction medicines could be provided where they're not being provided now. One is, for example, is through the drug court system. We have a very mixed bag with the drug courts. Many of them are simply not embracing the science and best practices associated with addiction medicine. A drug court judge said to me, "Henry, I'm not opposed to the use of methadone or buprenorphine. We just don't want it because we have a philosophy that is drug-free." And I pointed out to him that philosophy was a Greek word that meant the love of wisdom, and I didn't know how you could love wisdom and reject science. So there are a lot of additional venues where addiction medicines could be used and are not being used. Opioid treatment programs are certainly, you know, embracing it. The medically supervised outpatient programs licensed by OASIS, many of them are using it, others are not. Residential settings, a number of other outpatient settings.
If I could just, can I just ask the other doctors on the panel, do you concur with that conclusion about whether it's Voxone, methadone, for and along with treatment, is that the best way to go about doing it, or?
We've got an epidemic of people with the disease of opioid addiction, and that's why we're seeing heroin flooding into communities. People need to feed that addiction. Right. To bring this epidemic under control, obviously, for the people who already have this disease, we have to see that they have access to effective treatment. Mm-hmm. For the people with this disease, I think the majority of them will require long-term treatment with a medication. I believe methadone is less useful for the epidemic that we have today than it was for the epidemic we had in the 1970s, when you had an epidemic that disproportionately affected inner-city communities. Right. Having people go to a methadone clinic every day made more sense than when you have an epidemic that's disproportionately affecting suburban and rural communities. I think methadone is very important for a subset of people with this disease who need that structure.
Right.
But I do believe that Suboxone is probably our best tool for bringing this epidemic, or buprenorphine, under control.
Dr.
Just a little bit to add to my background. I've been in the addiction treatment business really for 30 years, board certified for 20. And I'm a chairman of the Department of Psychiatry, but I've run treatment programs for addiction and substance abuse and outpatient programs, community-based programs, because at Lutheran we have a very large clinic system, and I've also had a private practice, so I've seen people at all levels. Mm-hmm. And it's really clear that buprenorphine comes out way ahead. Methadone is very good, used as it's been for many years, and it was groundbreaking in terms of replacement therapy. Mm-hmm. Buprenorphine adds something new and different because it's more available.
Right.
It's still expensive, so it's hard to get to the underserved population.
Right.
Unless people have Medicaid, they can't get it, and they often lose their Medicaid, and then they go out of the hospital and they don't get it, and they come right back in the hospital, and that's something we need to attend to, in addition to the cost of naloxone, which we'll probably speak to as well.
Right.
But for most people who have become addicted to these substances and these addictions, hold on hard. They grab hold of the brain. They hijack the brain. Mm-hmm. These medications, which are replacement therapies and reduce the cravings for drugs and allow people time to make other choices, are critical.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing else has been more effective. Good treatment programs are good treatment programs, but these medications are a blessing to people, and we need to get them out there more.
Thank you.
A few words that I'll add, just to give you a sense of my background. Also, I'm currently at the city, as you heard, and I'm also an internist and board certified in addiction medicine, practiced both primary care and addiction medicine for 16 years in the Bronx. A few thoughts. I think the city's perspective, maybe we share many of the commonalities that you just heard.
Mm-hmm.
We very much support access to, availability of, awareness of medicines that treat addiction. For us, and from as I teach and talk about addiction, I think about diabetes. One would never say to a diabetic, gee, just really try to lose some weight and exercise. And if you need insulin, well, that's if it's really bad, or if you've failed your other approaches. That's not the approach that we take, I think, in medicine generally. We use the tools that are effective and what's available at the right time with the patient's consent. And as Mr. Bartlett said, the evidence surely supports the superiority of medication for the treatment of opioid dependence. And I think we are lucky that we have effective medicines and less lucky in the addictions from to some other substances. That said, there is tremendous stigma around these medicines, and as a public health practitioner now, one of our most important roles, both at the city and state level, I think, is to reduce stigma around addiction, around accessing treatment to addiction, and in particular around accessing treatment to medications for addiction. This is a terrible problem we have in the field, and I think it costs many lives. The issue of whether buprenorphine or methadone, I think our view at the city may be slightly different. I think both treatments are effective. I think methadone comes with certain kinds of restrictions at both the federal and state level that makes it sometimes less appealing to some folks interested in accessing treatment. But let us just be clear, we shouldn't confuse the medicine with how we prescribe or deliver it. And I think making both available in as many settings as we can will help us fight against the problem that we're facing right now, both here and nationally.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. Just a couple of follow-up questions. First of all, if anybody in the audience has any questions, please, you have a card. You can give it to my staff there, and we'll be happy to ask it along the way. Regarding methadone, for example, now, having toured some of the treatment facilities upstate, seeing that, as you say, doctor, in the urban center, that might be a different story, but I can think of one I visited upstate where people were traveling 2 hours each way, each day, every day. It just didn't seem like the most efficient use of treatment. And so this follows up my question with the drug Vivitrol, which is now a month, every month you can get a shot. Is that the answer, or are there downsides to that, or please?
I think for the people with the disease of opioid addiction, yeah, there's a small subset who might be helped by Vivitrol. Vivid, and that subset might be people who are young, who have not been addicted for very long, and who live in a controlled setting, perhaps with their parents. If they miss their monthly injection, the alarm is going off and the parents are bringing them in. Because the big risk with Vivitrol is if the person misses their injection, they are very high risk for an overdose death. So I think for some people with this disease, it's helpful, but it's a second line below buprenorphine and methadone.
We support the use of all three of the medications which are approved by the federal government for the treatment of opiate addiction. Each of them have their own strengths, and you're absolutely right, Senator Boyle, that the regulations requiring folks to come in so frequently to be medicated on site, at least initially, in methadone clinics are kind of draconian, and I would say that they don't serve the public health interest as much as maybe they did 20 years ago. But we really are we're promoting the availability of all three medications. We did a whole round of trainings for OTP staff, opioid treatment program staff, in how to use Vivitrol when it's clinically appropriate. I'd also point out that unless you get a discount, the cost of the injections is about $1,200 a month.
Right.
So it's an expensive alternative, but, you know, we're in favor of as many tools as possible in the toolkit.
Thank you.
I think one more thing that's worth mentioning is buprenorphine has been out for a while. It's a good drug, an easy drug to administer, and yet of all the drugs that we have, it's got very strange requirements as far as physicians to be authorized to prescribe it. And it has the DEA showing up at your office every once in a while to check and see if you're keeping a log of the prescriptions. And we don't do this for any other other controlled substances, so it's quite strange. But what it does is it is quite intimidating to physicians, especially non-addiction trained or non-psychiatric physicians, to take this on, which is really the initial intent. And until that changes, I think we're going to continue to see an underutilization of this drug. So anybody can get the word out anywhere, just talking to Andrew about this, and that there is some promise of some change, is going to be very, very helpful. There's just no reason for any restrictions, and certainly physicians need to be trained better in the prescribing of all controlled substances, all narcotics. They
right.
need CME training, and I would advocate for that being at least 1 hour mandatory to get relicensed in the state of New York about buprenorphine and prescription narcotics. But I think we'll see more people interested if we just make it a little bit easier to have it accessible, because it's so easy to use. The patients like it. They come back for it. They come back 30 days, and it keeps them off heroin.
Okay. Yeah, well, one of the things to talk about Suboxone, that we got testimony from a doctor upstate, the only one in his area that is, and it's a federally regulated, obviously, drug, so it is a certain state issue here, but we can try and lobby our federal colleagues. Well, he said he's the only doctor that does Suboxone. The auditor came in, and the first thing he did was read him his Miranda rights, say you have the right to remain silent. And he wasn't being accused of anything. It was just a normal. This was the interview, which gave him a bad feeling about even doing it. And that's a lot of physicians are gonna feel that way. They don't want to be put under a microscope like this. They want to help people, obviously, with addiction. Not the best system, and something that we are going to advocate to change, I believe. Senators,
Dr. Kunins, that. I believe it's your testimony, the written submission, that said that there were, to date, over 500 overdose reversals reported in New York City. And you believe that statistic may even be under-reported in terms of its quantity. I'm concerned in the more rural areas of our state, and including our small cities, where hospitals aren't accessible as they are in the major cities. What availability do we have, or should we establish for the reversal drug of most effectiveness, and how we deploy that? You have a myriad of sheriff's officers, state police, local police departments. It's not one department like there is in New York City, primarily. The state police has just yesterday announced how the Division of Criminal Justice Services and the Office of Alcoholism Prevention in our state is providing kits to state police officers. The question is, how much broader can we distribute this with a degree of certainty, and what type of distribution would you think would make sense?
Thank you for the question. So, just to give you a sense of what we've been doing in New York City since late 2008, as you know, the New York State has an opioid overdose prevention law passed in 2006, which allowed for the training of lay people to recognize overdose and administer naloxone, the medicine you're talking about. In New York City, starting in late 2008, we began to fund and distribute intranasal form of the medicine, which is, I believe, what's being used with law enforcement, to train community members, either who themselves were drug users and therefore at higher risk for either observing or experience an overdose, and to their social networks, to their friends and family. And we have, and that 500 at a minimum is really from that, by and large, that work since 2009, distributing through community member work. We believe that distributing through community networks provides it widely an incredible opportunity to prevent overdose fatalities. That is, to intervene by someone who is close to the person or is who a first responder. And we think that that gives, obviously, the person who may be experiencing an overdose another chance of reducing their risk, getting healthy in the future. We don't see much downside to the distribution. It sounds like that's what your question was based on. It's a safe medicine. It has some mild adverse effects that are temporary, not long-standing. From the
people wake up
in a start and can feel uncomfortable in the moment, but it passes really quickly.
Is there any special expertise necessary to administer?
So we liken it to other first aid strategies, EpiPens and so forth, that think about defibrillators that are widely available in airports and so forth. So it is at that level of administration. Easy to recognize, easy to administer. If you don't have an opioid in your body, doesn't have any ill effect. So if you get it wrong, in other words, it won't cause harm. We also, another concern that gets raised is, does it promote riskier drug use? We have no evidence to suggest that that's true. And then finally, you refer to access to hospitals. So obviously in New York City, with the density of hospital and healthcare facilities, that's not been a huge issue for us. Though part of the training is to encourage lay people, and certainly with first responders, to call 911 to get the person in for further monitoring and assessment.
Thank you.
Dr. If I could just follow up with that. One of the things, that I'm a former EMT, I've seen Narcan used like a miracle drug, but those with much more experience than I and others say that sometimes the patient will gets Narcan will wake up swinging and agitated. I mean, is there a way to, for a senior citizen, for example, to administer the Narcan nasally and just step away or go into the next room? Is that a strategy?
So certainly that's part of the training is to make people aware of that possibility. In our experience now monitoring this program for since 2009, we've not heard of sort of adverse effects from the people administering ever.
Okay.
People getting, I don't know, getting hit, falling down, or something like that. So that's not been part of our New York City experience at all.
Great.
And excuse me, please. Chairman, administering this drug does not, in your opinion, require any additional expertise than any normal EMT would have in terms of training in any event. Is that fair to say?
No, and again, I encourage you to think about it as a first aid procedure. Think about how widely we've been able to train lay people in a variety of first aid strategies, splinting, CPR, again, defibrillation that's available widely. I think it's really at that in that kind of domain of procedures.
Certainly, it's a first step in one of our segments, which is treatment.
Yes.
We want to make sure the person survives this ordeal. Doctor, from Phoenix House perspective, prevention, particularly for this age group seeming to fall into addiction in very uncharted ways. What would you prescribe we could do as a state to focus on prevention measures?
So I appreciate that question. All of you should have a graph. And I think to understand really how to deal with this mess, it's important to understand how we got here. And this is a CDC slide. This graph is the CDC's chief speaking point about the epidemic that we're dealing with nationally. And I'll explain what we're looking at. The green line represents opioid consumption in the United States. And what you see is that beginning in the late 1990s, prescribing of opioids began to take off. The red line represents overdose deaths from painkillers specifically. And the blue line represents addiction to opioids represented by people coming in for treatment. What the CDC is saying is that this epidemic was really caused by the medical community. That as doctors began to overprescribe these medications, especially for conditions where they're probably not safe or effective, like long-term chronic pain, like low back pain, that as the prescribing took off, it's led to parallel increases in addiction and overdose deaths. What the medical community and the dental community has inadvertently done in many cases, we've gotten our own patients addicted, or we've wound up stocking our patients' medicine chests with a hazard for their kids. So to bring this epidemic under control, we need obviously to treat people who have this disease, but we have to prevent people from getting the disease in the first place. And I think the most important way to prevent people from getting this disease, and there are many different things that need to be done, but the most important thing is to get the medical community and the dental community to prescribe more cautiously.
That gets to the supply. How about the demand? How can we engage in enhancing prevention at the outset by some type of encouraging certain types of behavior? And I think that's certainly, you've got the medicine chest, anybody can open it.
Yeah.
You've got the pills in there, anybody can take them. But how do you prevent them from taking them in the first place?
Well, I think the message that the medical community and the dental community needs to hear is very similar to the message that the public needs to hear, which is that these pills are essentially heroin pills. If young people understood when they're experimenting with drugs that this is not a soft drug, that this is a hard drug that could kill them, that can alter the rest of their life through addiction. If they understood that, they might be less likely to experiment with painkillers. But again, I think the real answer boils down to not exposing such a large percentage of our population to a highly addictive drug, and that's where prescribers come into play.
It's an excellent point. Thank you. Doctor?
I want to add, too, that iStop, which I think tremendous legislation and has had great effects on beginning to reverse diversion, has had other ramifications. At my hospital, I became responsible for really training physicians in iStop and getting up before hundreds of people in medical staff meetings and beginning to talk to them. And they were not happy at having to take this on at all. And most understood it, of course, to being it's something I have to do before I send the patient out the door with the usual prescription of a narcotic or whatever I'm prescribing, rather than thinking of it as something that I'm going to look at when the patient comes in the door or when I accept the patient for the first time, or I may do on all of my patients, because it, number one, tells me about what medications they're using, what their prescribing and compliance habits are, where they go to their pharmacies, what doctors they see, is that consistent with what they're telling me? So I've trained certainly my doctors I'm responsible for to get this at the front end. And the response is really very impressive. People really think this is a good system. They've learned a lot. They actually talk to their patients. And a lot of patients wander into this not knowing that accumulation of these drugs that they really don't understand because doctors haven't really educated them well about it, really do have adverse effects and build up, and you get caught in something you don't want to get caught in, or you get sick, or you're at risk, or your children are at risk. Once they find that out, they make changes. So doctors, I think, become more respectful with a program like iStop. The patients have become more respectful in understanding why it's important to pay attention to narcotics and why we need all of these, not only for what goes on the street, and everybody favors that. Among patients I've seen who are not addicts, is this is a good idea. We need to protect people, but also I need to be aware of myself. So I'm not sure people talk about iStop in terms of a good learning and clinical intervention, but that's what I found.
Doctor, you're still seeing in Luther Medical, is OxyContin and are the pill forms of the opiates still the largest number of visits that you're seeing?
Partly it's the demographic. I think and partly where you are in Brooklyn, of course, is Sunset Park, Bay Ridge, and so forth. And we know that lots of deaths are occurring in that whole area and have been occurring. There's always been a lot of heroin in our parts of Brooklyn. And the pills have been there, too. They've been prescribed. Not so much in our area of Brooklyn, but Staten Island is just across the bridge, and that's like an epicenter of prescribing of narcotics, and then Suffolk County too far away as well in terms of the map. So it gets in, it makes its way in. I think there's tending to be less, but it's hard to tell. It's hard to yet tell whether it's affecting heroin use. It's still there. I get very concerned, as everybody else, with new medications like Zohydro, which is, you know, what are they thinking to approve yet another drug that has no deterrence in it? We're putting another OxyContin out on the streets, potentially. We shouldn't be doing things like that. So as long as it's available, it's going to be there. And just learning from the gentleman to be speaking about the effectiveness of diversion tactics and work in the state of New York and how there's still a huge diversion of substances going on, it's still there. It's still dangerous. It's still the whole picture.
What's your capacity right now? Your capacity obviously has increased over the years now, especially in the last 2 years. What's your capacity today, and what do you see happening next year?
I think our ER is just like the statistics. I mean, we've seen that, threefold increase in people coming in with heroin overdoses over the last 10 years, and it still continues. I mean, so the visits continue. That's not counting the people who die, of course. And we know from going to town hall meetings and so forth in Brooklyn, you know, more and more kids, more and more young adults. In terms of availability of naloxone, I think it's great to put it in the hands of the first responders who are policemen and EMTs, but I think the real first responders are family members and friends, and even sometimes the victims of themselves. And I hope someday we're even talking about having like an EpiPen for allergic reactions that parents of adolescents and young adults actually have a naloxone pen in their home as a part of their emergency preparedness kit, because disasters do happen. And in this day and age, maybe everybody should have one, because you just don't know what your kid may get into.
I thank the young people that are in the crowd. There was a number of young people in and out of this room, and I want to thank them for coming to this today. Last question for me on this issue. Marijuana. Does anybody believe that marijuana is not a gateway drug amongst our professionals here?
I don't think anybody knows whether or not it is a gateway drug. We do, you know, it's an interesting question related to today's topic, because when we look at the populations that are most affected by the epidemic today, we're talking about people from suburbs who are white and middle class. In areas like Sunset Park, which were hit with a heroin epidemic in the 1970s, or in New York City's inner city communities, which are mostly African American or Latino, in many of those communities, what we've seen since the late 1970s has been a decline in heroin use, and since the 90s, a decline in crack cocaine use, but very heavy marijuana use. And when we look at the populations now that are dying of heroin overdoses, it's mostly white people. So what we haven't seen, despite very heavy marijuana use in some of those populations, we really haven't seen heroin or crack coming back into those communities, which would be evidence to suggest that perhaps it's not a gateway drug. It's a very complicated question. There are very good reasons to be concerned about marijuana, especially legalization, but whether or not it's a gateway drug is, I don't think we know.
20 years ago, would you say that OxyContin was a gateway drug?
I wouldn't call OxyContin a gateway drug, because OxyContin, oxycodone, is basically the same drug as heroin. It's essentially the same.
I have a question that I'd like to pursue with you, Doctor, regarding the pharmaceutical company's potential willingness to engage in an education program. Again, from your threshold statement, that heroin's addiction is a direct result of this use. I know they're in a dilemma, but I wonder what your experience has been with the manufacturers of those products.
Yeah, so that's a terrific question, and I appreciate it. I'm going to refer to this graph again. Now, suppose you're the manufacturer of a product where, as sales of your product are increasing, you're making enormous profits. It's associated with these horrible adverse outcomes like addiction and overdose deaths. You're not going to be happy about that. Even if you don't have a conscience, it's not good PR for your company. But at the same time, you don't want to see your sales go down. What the pharmaceutical companies are saying right now, in the context of an epidemic caused by too much prescribing of opioids, what they're saying is that this green line can and should continue to go up, because millions of people have chronic pain. But if we teach doctors what they call safe and effective opioid prescribing for chronic pain, we can make the red line and blue line go down. And that's not really true. I think in many ways the content of the education, the dominant education for physicians right now, they're being taught that if you monitor your patient very closely, if you check their urine, if you check iStop, all prudent things to do if you have patients on these treatments, but what they're saying is by doing these things you can turn this into something that's safe and effective that turns out rosy in the end. And it doesn't work. For example, if you start your patient with low back pain on long-term opioids and you're checking, so they say, well, check iStop. So you check iStop and you see 4 months into this, the young woman starts to visit multiple doctors. What that information is telling you is that the patient is now addicted. The doctor can say, well, I guess I can't prescribe for you anymore, but the patient is left holding the bag. The patient now has that disease, and if they can't get a doctor to prescribe painkillers, they'll seek heroin. So the education for the medical community should be, and it's the message the CDC is trying to deliver, the message should be these are good medicines for end-of-life care. They're good medicines when you use them on a short-term basis for severe acute pain, surgery, a severe accident. But we should not be putting patients on long-term opioids for common chronic problems. And unfortunately, the pharmaceutical industry does not like that message.
Can I follow up with that on a question? When we talk about prescriptions, is there a move or is there something that we can do to really regulate that prescribers can only do it in limited dosage or that refills have to be done in person? What would you say to that?
That's a terrific question. And I think one of the reasons we have this crisis today was really a failure of regulation. On the federal government's part, a failure to regulate the companies that were making these products. Had they regulated those companies appropriately, had they applied the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act and prevented them from promoting these medicines for conditions where they're probably not safe or effective, we might have prevented this problem. On the state level, and this is happening across the country, the state agencies that are supposed to protect the public from doctors who are prescribing recklessly are state medical boards. And across the country, they have really failed to do that. What should be happening is that state medical boards should be proactively using the same data that's in iStop to notify doctors who are prescribing these medications in high doses or in combination with drugs like Xanax that we're concerned about this. Don't do it. And if they see that it continues, to potentially investigate them. To have medical boards possibly take licenses away from doctors before they kill patients or before we have to put them in jail, and we're not seeing that happen. I think there is quite a bit that we could be doing here. And, you know, at the beginning, Chairman Boyle said that this would be an opportunity to suggest potential legislation. I think one thing we could be doing right now would be to say to doctors that have lots of patients on long-term opioids for chronic pain, perhaps doctors who have 10 or more patients on this treatment, where the data would tell you if you've got 10 patients on this treatment that maybe three of them are addicted, we could be mandating doctors who have multiple patients on long-term opioids to be trained in prescribing buprenorphine. We would be expanding access to this treatment exactly where we need it, where you've got the patients who are addicted. And what's nice about that is when a doctor finds out on iStop that the patient is doctor shopping, instead of firing the patient and saying, you're an addict, get out of my office, they would have the ability to treat that condition. I believe a bill like that may have been introduced by Senator Maziarb last year. I think MISNI didn't like it because it mandated doctors who have multiple patients on this treatment to do something, and MISNI doesn't like when you mandate doctors to do anything.
Well, Doctor, what's shocking to me, and I'm sure many of the members of this panel, is we travel around the state and we've heard from people that are suffering with this, and we hear about just recently doctors prescribing an initial dosage of 75 pills. Why is that continuing to happen when we have these highly educated professionals having the same data that we have? Yeah. What's the disconnect there?
Yeah, the problem is that the prescribers don't recognize that these are essentially heroin pills. If the dentist understood that a Vicodin was a heroin pill, I don't think they'd give a teenager 40 pills after a wisdom teeth procedure. They might give them one or two, or maybe they'd give them Advil. The prescribers are underestimating the risks of these medications, in part because they've been badly misinformed. The reason the prescribing took off, the prescribing that caused this crisis, was because of a campaign to encourage aggressive prescribing, and that campaign had quite a bit of misinformation in it.
And there has to be some responsibility here on the patient, too. The patient may not understand what they're getting. I know that's a doctor's responsibility, but think of yourself in a doctor's office here. He writes a script, she writes a script, and the patient goes on their merry way, not understanding the complexities of this medicine. Not being educated by the doctor, I think that's the threshold. But doctors have limitations too. They're educating patients may be another component of this. Any of the panel's thoughts?
I agree. I just want to also reiterate a few things that Dr. Kalani said. I do think we need to raise awareness about risks of prescription opioids with patients. As an example, in New York City, we ran a PSA highlighting risks of to a mom who lives in Staten Island, who perhaps we'll see tomorrow. And that, again, following on the intense marketing of these medicines as really being able to treat much more than they are claimed to treat and underestimating the risk. So re-educating the public. In addition, I want to just really reiterate what Dr. Kalani said, is it is easier to write a prescription for OxyContin right now than it is for buprenorphine. And that imbalance of regulation is perhaps something that the state or federal government might be able to address. In New York City, we've issued guidelines around what we call judicious prescribing to promote the kind of practice patterns that Dr. Kalani is referring to. For acute pain, 3-day supply of prescriptions is often enough. So the 75 pills is really typically not needed. Reducing the or increasing awareness that long-term use of chronic opioids typically does not result in better function or in pain control on average. And finally, these medicines are excellent for treatment of end-of-life pain. We do not want to see that reduced or access to that very important treatment. But I think raising awareness of doctors, other prescribers, who really, again, underestimate the risks, believe that they can pick out the patient for whom the opioid will be safe, is simply not true. We overestimate our effectiveness in that area, and doctors need to be engaged. And we in New York City have been engaging prescribers, and the state, we would welcome state participation in that as well.
When these kids are taking the doctor gets the Vicodin or the OxyContin, the kids don't know they're taking heroin.
Correct.
So we're talking about doctor-patient education here. We need to be able to educate the kids that are in our schools. You guys all remember, Dad, did this work when we seen that here, when those types of operations in our educational system, when we went into the schools? Did you see a drop-off in the – or not? Be honest with us. Did you see a drop-off in use of narcotics when you had these programs in our schools?
Well, I don't recall DARE focusing on painkillers. It may have focused on heroin. And what we're all recognizing is that the young people who are experimenting with painkillers and ultimately winding up addicted and then maybe turning to heroin, when they're using those painkillers, they didn't recognize that they were using a drug similar to heroin. In terms of the evidence that's out there supporting social marketing campaigns to prevent drug use, many of the campaigns that have been tried over the years haven't worked well. For example, Just Say No, which was Nancy Reagan's campaign, where the focus there was on modeling say no behavior. But there are effective social marketing campaigns that can prevent people from picking up a drug in the first place. It's very difficult once they're already using to get them to stop through social marketing. But the effective campaigns are the ones that dramatize the negative consequences of use. For example, the ad that New York City ran, I thought was a very good ad, which showed somebody using painkillers and dying of an overdose.
What about the educational system in our schools? You don't believe that we should go into our schools at the early grades, at third grade, fifth grade, sixth grade, and be teaching and laying this out?
I think that would be a very important thing to do.
So a DARE program, something similar to a program, not DARE, but something similar to a DARE would work?
So my awareness of the – I just want to summarize a few points about the science behind those programs. The DARE program has been studied and actually not shown to be terrifically effective, unfortunately, in reducing drug-taking behavior. Now, again, did not focus on prescription opioids, predates that. The science behind those programs are typically best when the programs focus broadly on social connectedness, family support, all the things that we know work to protect young people from risk. So those programs ought to be, in my view, broad-based, focus on integration into communities and families and around all kinds of risk-taking behaviors. So it is important to raise awareness about this specifically with school children, but there are educators and who are well informed about these strategies, and we should look to the science, again, not the medical evidence, but the educational evidence, to formulate those programs thoughtfully.
What are our public schools doing?
I would defer to my colleagues from the city DOE. There is health education happening in all the schools, and there is standard curriculum.
Thank you.
I think we're going to have to wrap up this panel. I appreciate your time very much. Any final words or thoughts that you wanted to say and didn't get a chance on a question? Or?
Just something to encourage you to work on as you're going around the state. Yeah. And I'd also like to just thank you very much for trying to really understand this problem and how to address it. I think we have to recognize that the populations that are most affected right now are very different from the populations previously affected by addiction. The crack cocaine epidemic of the 80s and 90s disproportionately affected people who were low income and minority and had Medicaid, similarly in the 70s. The people affected most today are people who are working class and middle class who have commercial insurance. And our whole system right now, our addiction treatment system, is very much focused on serving Medicaid populations. I think it's very important for you to sit down with some of the commercial insurers to make sure that we're funding the right treatment programs, that we've got the right models out there.
We are doing that, and I can tell you that insurance is going to be a big part of this legislative package, and the question of what medical necessity is, we're dealing with not only healthcare professionals but also insurers as well, to see if we can get an agreement by most. And I will point out, I'm sorry, we've been joined obviously by Senator Carlucci, who along with Senator Nozzolio is the vice chair of the task force. Thank you, gentlemen. That is a big issue. Thank you very much.
Now, I just wanted to point out briefly, talking about medical necessity, that frequently where a patient winds up in treatment depends on what door they happen to enter. And, you know, we've heard people say for years that there's no wrong door to treatment. I think there's a lot of wrong doors to treatment. And some people end up in a level of care that's inappropriate for them. Mm-hmm. OASIS is working now on a patient placement instrument and protocol called Locator 3. And, you know, Locator 3 is going to be used as part of Medicaid managed care. The managed care companies are going to be required to use this to determine the appropriate level of care and to use it for utilization review. Well, I say if it's good enough for the poorest people among us on Medicaid, it ought to be good enough for those of us who have health insurance. And it would be good for the health insurance companies to use some version of Locator 3 or a similar evidence-based instrument that places patients at the appropriate level of care to begin with, so we don't wind up with opiate-addicted individuals being seen in a level of care where they have a less than optimal chance of achieving recovery.
Wonderful. Any questions for the audience from our panel? I didn't see it written. Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry, Senator.
There's a question.
Hi. My name is Liz Berardi, and I'm here both representing my son, Carter, who you described completely. He passed away January 12th of an overdose of heroin. He had back surgery and was prescribed fentanyl patch after I told the doctor that he had a predisposition to addiction. And it was 2 months before I understood what was in that patch. And he was denied twice by MVP Value Options inpatient treatment that three Columbia doctors insisted he needed. I got him that help, but he ultimately died 3 days into a sober home. And I'd like to ask, I know it's an extension of what you're talking about, but it is an industry that is out of control. There's no oversight. It's a step down for many people, and it's actually, for many people, the only place they can go to get away from their triggers and to have their addiction addressed on an outpatient level. And I'm just wondering, it's a lifelong disease, is anybody considering regulation of sober and recovery homes? a standard that people can rely on in a database?
Yes, we actually just passed legislation like that in the Senate committee recently on regulation of sober homes. It has been a long time problem. I know Senator Zeldin from Long Island has a bill on that, and it's something that we should try to address. The problem is, as I'm sure you've heard, the state agencies are pointing at the town. Who's going to regulate? No, it has no treatment per se in some of these sober homes. What I experienced in the district I represent is we had people buying houses, taking in 30, 35 people with addiction problems, taking their social services money and paying off the mortgage in 2 or 3 years, and then selling the house and kick everyone out. They were in it just to make the money. They were not there to help the people.
The stories I've heard now that we've started Safe Sober Living from across this country, but I'll talk about New York today. One mother, they wouldn't take her son out of detox because he was on Suboxone. They gave her a list of other homes, and the manager was drunk when she arrived to visit it. A young woman told me that the manager was sexually harassing her. My son's case, the manager had no car. He used my son as his taxi driver and to visit his friends and so forth. And the, I'm not sure if he's a co-owner or he's the head of it, I found out was arrested in 2009 for while on probation for another crime, for selling heroin, Suboxone, and other opiates from his own driveway. And while still on probation in 2011, this man was managing sober homes. I mean, we have a problem.
No question. Well, we are very sorry for your loss, and thank you for
Yes,
coming.
But thank you, and I hope that really all these agencies can come together, and you are an amazing panel. So I'm grateful to be here today and hear you.
Thank you. In the back?
All right. I'm Matt Curtis. I'm the policy director at Vocal New York. We're a grassroots advocacy group that does work on behalf of people affected by drug use, HIV, and mass incarceration. First, a quick thank you to all the senators here today who all of you voted in favor of a bill that hopefully will become law very soon that Senator Hannon sponsored to allow much greater community access to naloxone. I think it's but through standing order prescribing. I think it's a pathway that we've seen work in other states that will be hugely beneficial for the Phoenix houses of the world and other things like that, making this important medication more available. Now a question, real quick. One thing that hasn't been discussed here, but I think that really needs to be considered as part of the public health response to this, is syringe access. And, you know, we've had 20-plus years of legal syringe access in New York State. We allow sales through pharmacies. And, you know, as what we've seen is not only has that been incredibly effective at reducing HIV transmission, reducing Hep C transmission, it's been a pathway for people to get into drug treatment, into primary medical care, into other kinds of things they need, and has reached people that wouldn't otherwise get access to those services. So, you know, it's become part of the mainstream continuum of care when you're dealing with opioid or other drug dependency. So the problem is we're now, with this new rise in heroin use around the state, we're starting to see, for example, through hepatitis C incident surveillance, new pockets of infections among young people around the state, and we've got major gaps in access in parts of Brooklyn and Queens in the city, and certainly in Long Island and most of upstate where there are very few providers. So I just kind of want to see if the panel or anyone here has any thoughts about including that in the kind of package of things that this task force will come up with in the future.
Thanks, Matt. So that I would like to just state our city's support also for the need for syringe access as part of the continuum of care. As you know, we at the city have oversight and fund, participate in the funding of the syringe access programs in New York City, and that is an area that is very important in engaging folks who may not come into other kinds of care. The syringe access programs do a lot of community outreach and are real experts in helping people seek whatever services they are ready for at the time, distributing naloxone, encouraging people to get tested for hepatitis C, engage in other risk reduction behaviors.
yield exchange, yes, no?
Yes, but okay. I will say the equation was easier when we had an HIV epidemic and when the heroin wasn't as good. And so just about everybody was, most people were intervened, injection users, and we realized that giving out clean needles wasn't going to turn people into heroin addicts.
Right.
It is a little more complicated today when the majority of people are beginning this addiction with pills, crushing pills, and when they're snorting heroin, there is a fair question about whether easier access to needles could encourage a transition from intranasal use to injection use. I do, however, think overall they're a very good thing, and they're an opportunity to engage with users and to test them for hepatitis C. I don't know that we've got evidence. I would ask Matt that syringe exchange is working all that well on reducing hepatitis C. It's worked very well with reducing HIV infections, but the virus is different. It's much easier to get a hep C, even if you're not sharing needles, you're just sharing works.
Just a quick question before I think we have a debate here, but is there any evidence of, are you more likely to overdose with the needle versus snorting it? You are.
You are.
Okay.
So just, I think Andrew raises some excellent points. One thing I just want to add, so as to not leave you with this place, is my clinical experience from the 90s in the Bronx is that many, many people came into methadone treatment having never injected. And this was actually, I think, in many ways, a great success story of the syringe exchange programs and harm reduction generally, which is they were the key awareness raisers about risks of injection. And that was a great success story that not more of my patients had HIV and had, in fact, never injected. And we obviously should take from those lessons aggressively as we're encountering this new epidemic.
Thank you.
And we need to work on hep C education and thinking about risk reduction.
Great.
Matt may have more.
Thank you very much. One last question for the panel, please. Gentleman in the back.
Hi, my name is Jeremy Thote. Sorry. Yeah. My name is Jeremy Thode. I'm actually an educator from Long Island, from suburbia, and just a couple of points just that I think you should hear. Number one, kids in suburbia and everywhere, they know that drugs work. They work for the purpose that they take them, and more kids in suburbia, I can say, are taking them to dull the pain, whether it's the stress they have in their lives, whether it's the issues with family, whether it's, you know, all different things that are going on in society. So you know, those things are very important. So piggyback on the point before, more needs to be done in the educational system. Nothing even close to enough is being done, and the DARE programs that are not being are not effective. And I would just urge this panel to consider putting more money into community coalitions that are popping up all throughout the state. They give us the ability locally to work together communities with the specific community issues that are going on in each specific community, and that may be a very good way to get the attention of that community.
Parents aren't educated, and they don't have the skills anymore to deal with
the issues. Thank you very much, and I do believe that our task force recommendations will be more of a holistic approach in that way. Panel, thank you very much. We truly appreciate you taking your time.
Thank you.
And the next panel will be regarding law enforcement issues and community involvement, Bill McGoldrick, Lindsay Sarsour, Rabbi Furman, representative of the District Attorney's Office here in New York City, and undercover investigator.
Rabbi. How are you, Rabbi? My pleasure.
He does a column with his wife in the Jewish Press.
That is, there's a woman here with you. Is that with you in the 50,000 cases?
Still line 173063275.
to start? Again, a lot of young people in the room. Again, I want to point out, thank you very much for being here and being part of this. I just want to ask, and don't be embarrassed by it, but because a lot of people, professionals, aren't aware of it. Anybody here recognize that Vicodin was heroin? Anybody here did not recognize Vicodin was heroin when they were growing up? Right? How many? Come on, be honest. Be honest. Come on, let's go. Right? So when did you, we're going to ask some questions later. When did you figure out Vicodin was heroin? Okay? Linda, I'd like to, real quick, what's going on in your community? And if you can please just briefly tell me what happened last week.
Just tie myself here, so I'll go on forever. So thank you, my state senator, Marty Golden, for having me here today. Starting probably for the past about 15 months, we've already had about 9 young men in our community between ages 17 and 23, up to the last one last week, a young man who died of overdose. All these young men have died of overdose. About 3 months ago, we had 2 young men. One passed away. One was at Lutheran for quite a while, originally from Morocco. He's out now and potentially trying to help groom, potentially having him to be some sort of spokesperson as someone who pretty much went to death and back. And we support this initiative and this task force and the impact that it has really on community, not just on the people who are kind of on the path to addiction or already there. And what we support also is a three-pronged approach, which includes the enforcement piece, includes the educational piece, and it also includes an alternative, alternative programs and opportunities. What we hope to see also is that, in a place like Bay Ridge, and with this particular population, we want to see, you know, multicultural and bilingual assistance, and I'm sure that's something that would be helpful to other communities as well, especially looking at the new populations of folks that are being affected.
This is new to the Arab American community?
Yes.
Very new in the past year or so, you'd say?
I would say 2 years now that we've been at least hearing about it. And I think the issue around it is that, you know, these are, like you said before and others on the panel have said, this is not about, you know, these like low income, you know, kids from the streets. These are from good families, you know, hardworking families, and their parents have no idea. They don't have bad parents. Their parents don't know what the signs are to understand.
Let me grab the rabbi now. Rabbi, are you similar up in your communities and around across the city? What are you seeing, Rabbi?
I think that we're seeing plenty of prevalence. We have at O'Hill Children's Home and Family Services, of which I'm director of operations, we receive foster care placement from mothers that test positive, you know, at birth from drug abuse. In our outpatient centers, we have individuals coming in for treatment. I think that there are 2 points I would say that are important. I think one is I actually am also president of a organization of Orthodox mental health professionals. And I sent out a email to the listserv asking for people's experience and polling them. And one of the common things that we found is I think that abuse starts oftentimes in youth through experimentation, through very innocent experimentation, because these are not found on seedy street corners. These are found in the family medicine chest. So clearly, early intervention and culturally sensitive intervention is extremely important. You know, in a parallel fashion, our organization has done a lot of work in the last 10 years in terms of sexual abuse in the Orthodox community. And it's a very similar idea that if you want to help educate a community, an insular community, you really need to understand their underlying beliefs, their assumptions, how they see themselves, and talk to them in a way that they'll get the message, because otherwise, you provide general education, but they don't think it applies to them, or in some way it doesn't apply to them the way it's being said. So we do feel that early intervention and education is very key and that it should be culturally sensitive.
Thank you very much. I want to go over to Mr. McGoldrick. Looking at what we're hearing between the communities across Brooklyn and across the city of New York, across the state of New York, unfortunately, I get killed in my own community when I say this, but it's true. Brooklyn is the capital of Medicaid fraud, Medicare fraud, welfare fraud, insurance, car insurance fraud. And we're moving into number one into 2 other areas, and that's drug diversion and it seems to be heroin death and overdose and death. Since we have concentrated areas, we know that we are the capital of in the nation on a number of these different issues. Isn't there a way of coming in here and going and looking at these points across the state, putting efforts into overlays, technology overlays, and understanding not just where these frauds are going, but specifically in the drug diversion and specifically in the pain doctors and specifically in the doctors that are selling or are moving these prescriptions and the pharmacies that are selling these? Can you help me out on that one?
Yes, thank you, Senator Boyle and Senators Nolasio and Golden for the opportunity to speak to you today. I'm an attorney with 32 years
experience. Pull the mic closer to you, please.
I'm an attorney with 32 years experience in New York State, but I'm also a retired detective sergeant from the New York State Police. For the last 20 years, I've been providing Medicaid fraud investigative and audit services to the United States Health and Human Services, Center for Medicaid, Medicare Services, New York State Department of Social Services, New York State Department of Health, New York State Department of New York State Office of Medicaid Inspector General, and New York City HRA. I'm accompanied here today by a confidential consultant who is a retired NYPD narcotics detective who has worked with me throughout those 20 years in a very specific area. We will refer to him as the detective. He is an expert in drug diversion. Our efforts have been focused in that area for the state of New York. The doctors who spoke this morning very well established the proposition that pills and heroin are hand in hand. The supply of pills that comes into the problem, that creates the problem, comes from the medicine cabinet, which education and awareness is a key. The detective actually this morning over coffee said, why don't the senators talk about having a piece of paper handed to people with the prescription and say, don't keep this in your medicine cabinet. You know, think Eddie Haskell coming to visit your house and asking to use the bathroom. When he knows the pills are worth $40 a piece, what's he going to do? You know, he's going to visit everybody's bathroom. So as the detective was saying, that's a very quick fix, maybe, a little piece of paper. Find a secure place to put this. That's number one. Number two, for years, I've been trying to get a straight answer on why we can't get a better disposal method. You know, in the old days, they used to flush it. It's dangerous stuff, but it's dangerous for the environment. Now people don't know where the recovery centers are, and people are not going to get on in their car or in the subway and go to some disposal center to get rid of the stuff. So that's one supply, the medicine cabinet. The AMA seems to think that 70% of the illicit trade, the stuff that's on the street that's being abused, is coming out of the medicine cabinet. I don't believe that. I believe that the majority of the illicit painkiller pills that are causing the problem now are coming out of drug diversion. And I have a crystal clear example of that, and it's in the form of two federal cases within 18 months. The United States...
If you can, when you're doing that drug diversion, also see how that leads into heroin.
Right, and it's they're hand in hand, obviously, from what the doctor said. The United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York, Preet Bharara, and it's in the package I gave you, announced two federal cases, one in July of 2012 and one only 2 months ago. And in both cases, the New York State Medicaid program, inadvertently and through fraud, supplied $500 million worth of pills in each case. So it's $1 billion worth of prescription painkiller pills that hit the street because the New York State Medicaid system was being defrauded. Now, Social Services, Health Department, and Medicaid Inspector General, all those years, there have been successive contracts for Medicaid fraud investigators, and basically they're retired members of NYPD, multi-ethnic, and they get out and they investigate the bad doctors, and the detective can tell you in a moment that's actually a very fruitful way to do it. You get the word off the street. You know, where do I go to get a prescription for Percocet or something like that? And it's a very direct way of dealing with it. These are licensed professionals. Unlike heroin, which is coming across the borders from many different countries, diversion of prescription painkiller pills involves professionals. There are pharmacies and doctors. It's a closed system, so you can take steps. every bad doctor that you kick out of the system who's prescribing $1 million worth of this stuff a year is going to say it's going to save lives and save the state $1 million.
The doctor pointed out earlier this morning about the how they were diversion, especially in these, let's say the pain health centers. Isn't there a way that we can do technology overlays to find out which health centers are doing the prescriptions and once you can find out who the addicted and how they're going into heroin and where the heroin's coming in and how is the heroin coming into Brooklyn?
The New York State Department of Health and the New York State Medicaid Inspector General and the New York State Attorney General have access to the MMIS system, which is the Medicaid Management Information System, and the fraud and abuse management system that sits on top of that. That's an IBM product. They can search for every prescription and patterns of prescriptions that were written. You can look for the doctor in the Bronx who's overprescribing and his stuff is all being filled in Suffolk, which is an actual case. They can look for a pediatrician who maybe somebody stole his pad. All of a sudden, this pediatrician is ordering oxycodone. They've got all these filters and edits that they can do. But they need the staff. Up until September 30th, 2011, there were 60 people working on this kind of stuff on outsourced contracts. Those contracts ended at the end of September. Within 10 months, the federal U.S. attorney had his first $500 million case. There was a limbo period where those contracts didn't exist at all, and at the end of that period, when they just started to come up again, there was the other $500 million case. Instead of 60 people, they've got six. So that's something that, you know, the senators can address. It's going back to OMIG and find out why that contract, or those, there's three of them, why aren't they being used? They're contracts for auditors, nurses, computer people, and investigators. I don't know if it's for lack of funding. If it is for lack of funding, I can tell you this. For 20 years, it's been calculated that it returns at least 10 to 1 on the money. So if it's $5 million a year, they're saving 50. The detective, I wanted him to tell you about something that's happening now where you have these illegal pharmacies popping up. We just spoke about this over coffee. Drug diversion has so many ramifications that it needs a lot of study. In addition to putting the dangerous pills on the street, part of the act of a criminal diversion ring is to sell the medication back to a pharmacy who buys it at 10 cents on a dollar and keeps selling it. Now, it doesn't have to be painkillers. It could be HIV meds. One of the most despicable things I've ever heard was New York District Attorney General case. They arrested two pharmacists who were buying the life-saving HIV meds from the AIDS patients before they took it. You know, it's a special place in hell for people like that. But I'll ask the detective now to explain what's going on in certain areas of the city, and it's kind of part and parcel with that, where legitimate medications are coming out of the pharmaceutical supply chain and then being dangerously reintroduced.
Good morning, Senators, and thank you for having me here today.
Mike Flosser, please.
This is an education thing that, you know, like the first committee said, people need to be educated. I can go out all day and get you whatever you want, but if you don't educate the public, it's going to keep happening. And there are pharmacies out there that are buying prescriptions. They're buying your medications back. We have an area in the Bronx where bodegas are getting into the game now. They're buying medications from people and reselling it or shipping it out of the country. It's a big epidemic. You know, it needs to be, we also need to educate people on how to get rid of their medications when they don't use it. Not everybody's addicted. There are people that are legitimately have their medications, but they need to get rid of it, and there's no way of getting rid of it. And
well, staying at the pharmacy, the bogus pharmacies, I got to tell you, I'm getting an education here myself here this morning. Where are they? And how do we know they're out there?
They're in all the boroughs. They're in all our boroughs.
You're talking about people that are set up that are inside the operation, that are workers within the operation, but it's actually the owners of the pharmacies that are doing this.
There are people that stand outside the pharmacies that are steers.
Okay.
Okay. Sometimes they work with the pharmacy. Sometimes they don't work with the pharmacy. Sometimes they're on their own. But sometimes they work with the pharmacy. We have doctors that take money to write you a prescription for painkillers.
Well, we've always had that.
Right. So you know, it's an epidemic, and people need to be educated on it, on how not to do that, and how, you know, to prevent from getting caught up in that.
Wouldn't the audits and the overlays, technology overlays, wouldn't that show where the doctors are again with the eye slap and with the shopping of doctor shopping, and where there's more prescriptions coming out of a certain borough or a certain town, village, or city?
Yes, the eye stop will prevent the overprescribing part of the illicit supply. What the eye stop doesn't stop is this criminal diversion. And very quickly, the way it works is they borrow a Medicaid card from somebody. You know, they may go to a men's shelter and give a guy a $20 bill and take his card. They get a prescription that was stolen. In your package, there's a picture of a stand on the Grand Concourse where all they did all day long was buy stolen blank prescriptions, and then they would sell them to the people on these teams. Then there's a picture in there in that package of a script writer. All she does is sit down with them and write the prescription for what they want. That's her job, and she gets paid for that. And then there's a picture of the man who escorts the people into the pharmacy, sees that they get the prescriptions filled, puts them in his shopping bag, and then they move down Tremont Avenue, in that case, to the next pharmacy and the next pharmacy. That criminal diversion team is not going to be stopped by iStop. It's not going to show up. iStop is a very good program, a very worthwhile program, but that's only one segment of the illicit supply. The three major areas, I believe, are, number one, criminal diversion of prescription drugs, and we happen to have a penal law statute for that, which is a very good statute. It has felony levels, so it's serious. I think the next is the theft out of the medicine cabinet. I think that's in the amount of volume, that's next. And the last is the doctor shopping. But I want the detective to tell you about the non-professional locations that are getting into the pharmacy business now.
We have a certain amount of bodegas in our Bronx area that are also getting into it. They're buying the prescription drugs from people, and they're selling it, or they're sending it away. Sometimes a big part of that is Viagra, Levitra. They're selling it out of their bodegas. You know, you have eight bodegas in a two-block area. You know, they're not all selling grocery, you know? And, you know, we don't know if they're involved with pharmacies, but that's part of it.
And the point to take away from that is there's so much money in this stuff that it's a rapidly growing enterprise. When it's $40 a pill, 180-count pill supply, according to the federal case, by the time they get finished selling it up the chain, that one prescription that got filled could be worth anywhere from $6,000 to $18,000. And the way I described a criminal diversion team, you can see it's not hard to assemble, not hard to get a Medicaid card, and apparently it's not hard to get scripts that are all part of the package. So, again, this is one particular area and I believe the major source of these pills that the state can do something about. There are contracts in place, and they just have to put that back to the robust program that it was.
Let me follow up with you, Counselor and Detective. You're assured that the statutes we have is, in terms of criminal conduct, are sufficient? But they're certainly not sufficient to deter this action.
Criminal diversion of prescription drugs goes up to a C felony, and that's a pretty good – that particular segment is covered.
I'm chairman of the Codes Committee, and I'm very interested in your assessment here of this. Go ahead.
How much drugs do you need to get a C felony on a drug diversion?
You know, the face value would have to be about $5,000. It kind of goes up like the old grand larceny statutes by the value of the drugs.
And it goes for the seller?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. That back to this inquiry that it's these graphs that we were shown at the last hearing, where you've got the enormous growth of opiate sales. These are, I assume, the doctor gave us opiate legitimate sales.
No, that because
what kind of graph would we see if this was into the black market that you suggest?
Well, ironically, because take the $1 billion in sales that were represented by the two federal cases, they would show up on that chart because they billed the New York State Medicaid program $1 billion. $1 billion represents 2% of the entire state budget for Medicaid. That was over an 18-month period. But, I mean, and that's only two cases. And one of the problems, and I've talked to, I had lunch with representatives from three of the pharmaceutical manufacturers 2 weeks ago, looking to get funding to do something with NYSAC, the New York State Association of Counties, which has a very strong interest in this. And they tell me that the problem is that they keep hitting the system by resale of these drugs, and they're contaminating the drugs, and they have counterfeit drugs coming from foreign countries. I mean, it's so bad that they're getting calls from Iowa, their security divisions, wanting to know why the 40-milligram stuff is in a 30-milligram package. There was a case on Tremont Avenue reported in the Post, a seven-year-old boy whose mother got a prescription filled for Ritalin accidentally got an adult dose of methadone and very nearly died. That's a result of a pill mill operation. The stuff goes out legitimately, but it looks like a legitimate sale. And it is a legitimate sale because it's billed to the state. But now it comes back in. We've got two pharmacists who work with us who are also retired NYPD. They've been in some of these pharmacies where they were accompanied by law enforcement because now they're going to, place is going to get taken down. And there were dozens and dozens of these pill bottles that were brought back from the street, purchased back, opened, waiting to be resorted. And it's not just limited to painkiller medications. It's limited to anything that's worth, well, not limited, it's anything that's worth money. Asthma medications, heart medications, any of us could wind up going to get a prescription filled for anything and get something that's been out on the street in somebody's trunk, mixed around and put back in. So criminal diversion of prescription drugs is an emerging problem, and I think it's the leading problem of the pills, which the doctors have told you now is the leading problem, leading cause, or the causal connection for the heroin. And this is something the state can do something about. They've done it before, and they've done it very effectively. I suspect that with the Medicaid redesign team and a couple of other things, this kind of fell out. Somebody didn't realize that these three contracts that sit in OMIG right now are being underutilized, and there was an 18-month gap.
So, Counselor, thank you for this assessment. We're grappling with, as the chairman of the committee said, that it's a three-prong approach. You've got prevention, treatment, and then prosecution. And we need to focus on the supply aspects here, is what you're telling us, the illicit supply.
Yes.
Not the legitimate supply. I mean, I know the doctors were saying it's just more more pills in mommy and daddy's medicine chest. Well, it's not that, according to what you just described.
That's the number two source by volume. I wouldn't know what it is. But the number one source right now is criminal diversion of prescription medications. And it's through their New York State Medicaid is getting hit very badly, but other prescription benefit programs are getting hurt as well.
You feel in terms of the elements of prosecution and the statutes are significant enough to allow and enable the prosecution. It's the investigation and apprehension is where the challenge appears to be.
Yes, it's a very specific area, a very specific expertise to investigate it. NYPD, we've worked with the various, all the DAs. All the DAs are aware of the problem, but nobody has the resources. And imagine, I mean, we had a team that included two NYPD members who were pharmacists. We had nurses, doctors. And it fell out. After it fell out, $1 billion in fraud occurred in just two cases. So it's a pretty clear indicator of or an argument to restore the efforts at OMIG.
Thank you.
On a Medicaid card, and I'm just throwing this out there, it may not be possible because of the large volume and because of HIPAA. Isn't there the state that when they give out the Medicaid cards, isn't there an unusual, is there any way of doing an unusual medical usage?
The state sometimes restricts recipients who are suspected of abusing the cards. You know, you always have the fine line of wanting people to get treatment And then, of course, you've always got the criminals who will abuse, you know, any kind of a public benefit program. One of the problems in the system, I'd have to double check, but for as long as I can remember, a lost Medicaid card was replaced with another card with the exact same number, which, you know, so you have dozens and dozens of cards with the same number, so you couldn't even track. You know, the guy could say, well, it wasn't the card that I have.
Couldn't
so
they track the same person that lost the card four times in a year or a stolen card three times in a year?
Again, they can put some people if their numbers. You can tell from the fraud and abuse management system that sits on MMIS. You can tell if certain recipients' cards are being abused. And that's for New York. If it was New York City, that would be for New York City HRA to call the person in and evaluate what's going on. They can be put on restriction where they have to go to a certain pharmacy and use certain doctors, but that's not the part of the problem. The fact that you can rent a Medicaid card, you know, from the indigent population, people who are homeless, people who are out of men's shelter, that's hard to control. But what you can control, because it's a closed system of professionals, is the prescribing doctors, the ordering providers, and the pharmacies, things that are going wrong on the pharmacies. And you don't need, I mean, it's great to have it, and it's a great way to make the cases, but you don't even need the sophisticated computer models and all that. The detective will tell you, he can go out on the street right now and get the name of six doctors that are writing prescriptions. It's not that much of an investigation to build up a case to have the doctor arrested and thrown out. We had one pharmacy on Tremont Avenue with video and audio. We had pictures of them buying Medicaid cards and buying drugs back. You know, they're not difficult cases to make, but there's a lot of them to be made, and there's not enough effort.
Legislation that you think we can pass at this Senate that you think could help? And are the DAs, are there enough incentive for the DAs to take these cases and to help in the city and the state?
Within the last year, I've met with each of the five DAs in New York City, and I've met with DA Kathleen Rice in Nassau and Tom Spoda out in Suffolk. They're all dying to do something. They all said they would love to have resources like this. There's a proposal that we have through the Suffolk County DA to put together teams for Long Island, where they're losing 10 people every month for 2 years. The statistics that the doctor from the city had, 58 people a year in New York City, two western counties, six a month in 58 people a month in New York City, I mean, six in the western counties of the state. So you're talking about 60, 70 people a month. It's time to get a couple of projects together and get it studied. You know, there are enough knowledgeable people around who can look at the different aspects of the problem and come back to you with suggestions for changes in the law.
Your testimony is very helpful. Elaborate a bit on the abrupt ending of those contracts that were used to for the Medicaid Inspector Fraud, Medicaid Inspector General, in terms of this ferreting out fraud. So the contracts abruptly ended, then restored after 2 years of dormancy.
Yes.
And that, but you said 18 months, those investigations contracts were restored, but on a very minimal and ineffective basis. Could you elaborate on the minimal and ineffective part?
There are six, instead of a staff of 60, there are six. Two investigators each from three companies who have experienced companies. And because of that two-year gap with no investigations, the Medicaid Inspector General's office had a 9,000-case backlog. So they're trying to prioritize, and their mission is not only prescription drugs. It's all forms of Medicaid fraud, fraud in transportation, ambulettes, labs, all manner of fraud. So that's one segment of it. To my knowledge, of the six investigators there right now, there may be one or two, and that's it. So it's not a program anymore, and it's of all the things they do, if you want to put saving lives first and reducing the public health crisis, that, to my mind, would be the primary mission of that unit right now.
Although certainly the costs the benefits are
It always pays 10 to 1. We had an HIV case. There was a growth hormone by the called Serostim that was being diverted and sold back to the pharmacies. And it was very, very expensive medication. The state was spending $120 million a year for like 10 years on that stuff. When the investigation was concluded, it was reduced to $80 million a year and stayed at that number for 10 years. So to my mind, those contracts paid for themselves forever, right then and there. And that case was found by a New York City detective, Patrick Kelly, Lord have mercy on him, he's no longer with us, just by doing what cops do. He was out by a pharmacy, he saw something suspicious, they found out the person had a forged prescription, they brought it back, they got the pharmacist, and they said, what is this stuff? And the guy said, well, that's a growth hormone for AIDS patients. Why are they selling it? Well, we don't know. Well, it just was because it was an expensive medication, and by getting it for nothing with a Medicaid card and then selling it back to the pharmacy, they were able to bill the state $2,000 a dose for every one of those that they did. And nobody was treated with the drugs. It was just a classic pill mill where they sold it over and over again. So if the outsourcing of Medicaid investigations ever proved itself, it proved itself on that one case. The investigator himself brought the information back to them from the street, and it resulted in a $40 million a year savings for many years. So that's the diversion part is something that the state can actually do something about. And this is the marijuana discussion about Gateway, whether it is or it isn't. We now know that the pills are the superhighway. They're the direct route. There's a direct cause.
Anything that popped up here today that you think that we can do that strengthen some of our laws here in the state of New York that would help in preventing more actual overdoses and sales and death?
I definitely highly support the crackdown on the pharmacies and the doctors and that partnership. That's absolutely happening. I won't deny that that's happening. But what I'm concerned about is that the people that are being impacted from our community are not the kids that are going into a pharmacy with a prescription. That's not what they're doing. So I'm trying to figure out to balance the enforcement piece and the legislation around, you know, monitoring the criminal diversion, which I think the drug diversion, which I think is a big issue. And I know that even stories that we've heard where there's been a couple of doctors, I remember 2 years ago there was one in Sunset Park that got caught on that. But I just don't think that that's what this population of 17 to 23 are not the ones going into the pharmacies. So I'm trying to figure out.
Into their mother and father's medicine cabinets, though, aren't they? Don't these Skittle parties?
They're doing Skittle parties, but they're also being sold those pills by the pill. So there are some pills that they're buying for like $5 a pill. They're buying, their kids are showing us, you know, little Ziploc bags that they find with their friends or at their friends' houses. So the kids are being really honest about the stories and how they're getting the pills or how they see their friends taking the pills. But, you know, back to the original, like, the legislation passes and then there's always the enforcement piece and how long does that take? But in the meantime, how many more kids in our community have to die, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to figure out also back to the gentleman in the back who's an educator from Long Island, the idea of like for example in Bay Ridge, you know this, Senator, like we don't have youth programs, like we don't have a PAL program in Bay Ridge. Kids don't want to go to McKinley Junior High School if they're 16 to play at a junior high school. Just figuring out what other alternative programs can we add to a larger holistic approach to combating this issue, because I just don't want to see another mother in my office crying and telling me she didn't know why her son didn't wake up in the morning because he came all home. And that's how all our kids die. They're literally, they just don't wake up. That's most of the stories that at least 7 of the 8 kids, their mother went to wake them up in the morning to go to school or to go to work, and they just don't wake up. And that's how their mother finds out that later on that it was an overdose. They can't tell. They don't smell like marijuana. They can't smell it on them. They can't see it in their eyes. They just don't know how to. So how do we get all those points? But we as a community wholeheartedly support the enforcement mechanisms and any legislation. We would be willing to stand to say that we would crack down on doctors and pharmacies in this work.
Now, Linda, how about in cases, and I don't know if you've experienced this, where it is obvious that someone has a problem and they maybe come to you or look for help. Have you had experiences like that with and finding treatment for people that need it? Because we've heard this problem where it's obvious someone has a problem. Mm-hmm. They're actually looking for help and not able to get the treatment that they need. and we've heard from private insurance, but other issues as well. Do you have any experience with that?
And my colleagues from Lutheran, I used to work at Lutheran actually, but, you know, the people think it's an easy process. They think that they show up to, like, a center, like, at Lutheran, and then they, like, take you, and then it's all, like, great. That's not how it is. I mean, there's a waiting list. There's also an age limit. Like, Lutheran, for example, they don't do adolescents. Like, that's not their focus area. So, like, our population, talking about kids between, you know, that are, I mean, the ones that have passed away are 17 to 23, but we know kids using this as young as 13. That's not a population that they focus on. And the other issue around it is, like, you want to be able to treat kids with the partnership of the parents, right? But if you don't speak their language, if you don't, back to my brother over here, like, this assumption is that when we're talking about drugs in a community, this community doesn't think that's them. They don't, for example, we don't even talk about things like HIV in our community because, you know, us, we're, like, religious and we're, you know, monogamous. Like, there's a lot of issues in our community that require a level of sensitivity. And I think the way you do that is you go through faith-based, community-based organizations who understand these. So back to another proposal in the back around building coalitions of government, you know, and this is something that's already happening in our area, government, faith-based, community-based organizations and others, you know, the school system, and creating this partnership, because our community also is about, you know, you don't want to think I'm a bad parent because my kid's on drugs. So sometimes they wait too long. Maybe they do know. They wait too long because they're worried that people are going to, you know, talk about them, like, as if that's more important than their child's life. And I think we could be very helpful in being the liaisons between the community and this issue, but also having community members stand up and say, if the pharmacies are getting this on the streets of our community, then we're going to stand against that. If the doctors in our community are bringing this to the streets, we're ready to stand against them. And how do we create that holistic approach?
One of the things, Linda, that we've seen in other forums, and I'd like to get out of this task force, is to change the stigma involved. You mentioned that, where, you know, if you walked up to someone in the street and they said, "Well, my son has cancer," you thought, "Oh my God, what can we do to help?" No one wants to mention that their child is an addict, but it is a disease, and that's the bottom line. And I think that mindset is changing, but we're not there yet.
Absolutely. The Rabbi, did you want to add anything?
Well, first of all, I absolutely concur with what Linda said. And I'll also just share with you that there's a saying in the Talmud that the mouse does not steal. Rather, it is the hole that steals. And, you know, clearly, enforcement and prevention are very, very important, no question about it. But I do think that when you're dealing with families and young children, the education piece is extremely important. And also, somehow you have to find a way to balance the fear that comes with enforcement versus you want people to feel comfortable coming forward. And that's always a problem in any area of mental health, because there's a criminal aspect to many kinds of mental health crimes and related crimes. So we need to find a way, and part of that is with cultural sensitivity, however, just plain old sensitivity too, to find a way where people feel comfortable to get treatment and to talk about their problems, and yet that we have strong enforcement, because you have to have both.
About 2 months ago, we actually brought information to the 68 precinct about a potential apartment where we think that someone, a mother and her sons, actually were part of this, like, selling, right? And when these kids told us this, and I asked them, like, how long do you think has it had? They were like, oh, this has been happening a long time. And I'm like, why didn't you ever tell anyone? And what they were worried about, and this is something we should think about, is they were worried that if the, you know, NYPD undercovers are going to be monitoring this, like, location, that would the kids who were coming out of that apartment be then subject to the enforcement around that? So our kids are the ones with the information. They know who's selling in our community, but what they're worried about is if they come forth or they find something on them, that they're going to be part of that. And I personally can't guarantee to you, because I'm not in law enforcement, to say to them, no, we want this information. You can be helpful to us, and what that looks like, because I think that's the apprehension about bringing information, is that these young kids who are need a lot of things, but they don't need to be arrested and put behind bars, because it's not them. They're not the problem. So I'm wondering if that's something we're thinking about when we're looking at the enforcement piece, that these young kids are not caught up in the system. That's actually kind of...
In most cases, NYPD uses undercovers, and they use those that are coming out into a drug sale. Generally, they've watched and observed this individual several times. The unfortunate reality, we did do an event in Bay Ridge, and it takes, you know, a good several months by the time you do a number of buys to be able to get that to crime to stand in a court. So it takes a period of time to build a case. So while that takes that time, that drugs are still being sold at that location. So people get upset because they think the police department's doing nothing, or, you know, why is this allowed to go on and to exist? What they're doing is are building cases, and you've seen the number of cases that have been brought in the past several weeks and how many people have been arrested in that community because of drugs. So it does take time, but it does come. The community has to let us know. The Muslim and Arab American community is very insulated, and same in Jewish communities. So they have to be the ones that have to come forward to let us know where the locations are, and we have to be able to get in there and get our undercovers in there and make sure we make those arrests, and we will. And we have, and we will save lives as long as there is a communication, which I think is a good communication today with NYPD. I think Lutheran is doing a good job, but Lutheran's limited in HIPAA, and they're limited in why they can intervene in a family. We've had families come into our office that did not want the community to know that they had a problem, and that we've taken those children. There's going to be some providers coming up here, and they're going to speak very shortly, and we've gotten them into treatment. And that's what it's about, is getting the people into treatment that are addicted. What we want to do, though, we want to make sure we get the drugs out of the community. And if they're in the community knows. So they got to let us know. And I think we have a much better working relationship today than we had in the past when it came to drugs, and we're going to continue to do that. Anything else can you can add? Anybody from the audience want to ask a question here? Go ahead, sir.
My name is Luke Parker. I'm a member of Dynamic Youth, and I've been a recovering drug addict for the past year. And my question is about education, because as when I was a kid, I was educated as to what drugs were. My cousin was a recovering heroin addict, and I knew what it could do. That didn't stop me from doing any of the drugs. I went to the DARE program. I did all of these things knowing what could possibly happen, and it didn't really stop me. I feel that when it comes to education, if you put a group of children or young adults in with an adult or an older figure or someone that holds, you know, authority, it's less interesting. It holds less value to you. When I was younger, I would get more advice, and I would take it in better from people that were my age. Mm-hmm. I feel that when it comes to education, it would be better if someone that was going through it or has done it recently and is of the same age range could teach the younger children about what we've gone through, how we've dealt with it, and what it will cause. I feel like if I wanted to know if there's a way that could happen.
Yeah, we certainly have advocating for peer-to-peer education, and I think that we've heard that a lot around the state too. I mean, it's one thing to have the police officer come in, the person you can't relate to, but some we have young people who are still going through it that experienced what they went through, and that scares people. I think it has much more of an effect, we'll say, and we're certainly going to try and add that to our package.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, hi. My name is Nazar Ramawi. I'm a CASAC with OASIS, also a resident of the Bay Ridge area. My family and I have known Marty Gold. Try to do our best. I honestly think a big part of the law enforcement is going to have to get involved. The community, the kids are very private, very quiet. They are scared, but not scared in the manner where it could be beneficial to them, themselves, and their families. So that is one factor. Also, maybe like an anonymous toll-free number that can be used that families can speak, because it's a two-part disease. The family suffers as well as the children and the community as a whole. So that is one area I think maybe the Arab American Support Center can work on, you know, having some type of also like a liaison between Medicaid, because it's very expensive to get treatment. A lot of people want treatment. A lot of people don't know how to go forth in getting it. So maybe somebody from like Medicaid informing them of long-term HRA type benefits that are available. But I think a big part has to do with what the NYPD has been working on, and just applying a little bit more pressure in not giving so many options other than to work with them or to be mandated to a long-term treatment program, which I feel is probably the best treatment plan. It would give the families time to heal. It would give them time to heal. But it all falls into the place of enforcement of, like the rabbi mentioned, fear. There is a lot of fear, but not fear in the sense where they can recover from it. It could be a motivator, and that is a key area which I think that, I know, Marty Golden, you have a lot of these pamphlets in your door, you know, with internet and safety and parents, and that looks a lot towards the generation that has not been affected by it, you know, and parents really getting involved. You know, I work a little bit with Apple with development, and they would love to participate in different kind of programs to work with the kids who are not just from the Arab Bay Ridge. Is very diverse. You have every nationality in there. So getting them in there prior to them going to high school, and the peer pressure factor is very big. So kind of breaking it up in that area, but I think that would be a positive.
There are faith-based operations out there that do get a person from their home to Medicaid, to a treatment center. My office does it. Others will do it. Yeah. They're out there. The unfortunate part is a lot of people don't know they're out there, and I think that's the education part that my colleague Senator Boyle has talked about is something that we have to look to do better.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I have a question for the young man that stood up. Would you be so kind as to indulge me in a question? First of all, thank you for your courage. It took an awful lot to stand up in the middle of a room and tell us about your personal journey, and I appreciate that very much and respect it very much. Help us by understanding how you said you had the DARE education, you said you were a participant there. What elements encouraged you to begin this type of conduct, taking the opiates? Was it availability? Was it opiates themselves? Were there gateway drugs? I mean, what got you engaged in this?
It started with smoking marijuana when I was very young. And when I was probably about 16, I started smoking marijuana. And what happened, the opiates was Klonopin, was something that I liked because my mom had it in the bathroom, in the
medicine
little
chest.
Medicine chest, exactly. And once I got that, my other friends knew about other drugs, and I kind of just experimented a little bit. And it kept going until I ended up in rehab.
So that was Senator Golden's question earlier today, in terms of what is marijuana, in fact, a gateway drug?
And to me, I believe it is, yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, thank you for your courage and your comments.
Right. Okay. Another one?
Go ahead. Good now?
Good.
All right. Thank you all for having this panel. I really appreciate it. My name is Brett Wilson Stofko. I'm a graduate student at the Albert Einstein College of Medicine up in the Bronx and a volunteer with a syringe exchange up there as well. So I found my brother when he had overdosed on heroin. We didn't know he was using, so we had no naloxone on hand. We were at the mercy of the paramedics getting there on time to bring him back, which thankfully they did. So I was in the situation of not having any resources available. And it seems like a lot of other people are in the same situation. And so we all, though, have in our households fire extinguishers for that rare occurrence of a fire. Why don't we all have naloxone in our medicine cabinets on the rare chance of an overdose? It seems kind of a very pragmatic approach. There's different ways of going about it. I mean, of course, education plays a huge role, and being it more available from, like, over-the-counter availability would be one thing, which I know is moving through right now. Another would be a co-prescribing mandate, which I've suggested, in which the first opioid prescription per year per patient, regardless of dosage, would get naloxone with it. And what that would do was it would widen the naloxone distribution network so that any household that has an opioid in it also has naloxone. And the naloxone lasts the shelf life for 2 to 3 years. So even if that dosage is gone and then some problem arises later on down the line, naloxone is available, and a person's life can be saved. And so I just want your thoughts and also on just like wider, your ideas on wider naloxone distribution. Thanks.
Well, I think we all certainly support the wider distribution. I know that many of us have had classes. I held one on Long Island last week. We had 150 people taking the class. One of the things is we need to straighten out and have a uniform system in New York State on how to get that into people's hands. These classes, you have to take the class to get certified. Obviously, you can, it's about a 45-minute class. It's not that hard. And we are looking for wider prescription. The idea of giving a doctor giving it with the prescription, the problem is they haven't taken that class. But we do want to make it as widely available to first responders, certainly to lay people, family members of addicts themselves. We have done a pretty good job of getting it more widely distributed, but we're going to go further with this legislation too. Thank you. Yes?
Good afternoon. And thank you, gentlemen. My name is Clarence Bowden. I'm one of the directors of New York Therapeutic Community Serendipity One. And this is more of a comment statement, but it's also going towards that gateway question of marijuana. I haven't heard anything about alcohol being mentioned. I've done sessions with older gentlemen who talked about 6 and 7 years old being sent to bring a drink to the parent, the alcohol spilling on their hand, them licking it off, and it progressing over time till they become an addict. All right, so let's not forget alcohol and its role in this gateway process. Yes, I agree, marijuana is one of those gateway drugs, but alcohol is right up there in that same realm. So that's just my comment and my statement.
I don't think anybody here disagrees with you. Go ahead.
Okay.
Thank you.
But that's what my statement was.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank the panel very much for your input and insights.
Thank you very much.
Our next panel is a representative of Dynamic Youth Community, Samaritan Village, Bridge Back to Life Center, and MASK. And this is our final panel, and if you could briefly introduce yourself and tell you where you're from.
Good afternoon. I'm Gary Butchin, the president and CEO of Bridge Back to Life Center. We're a network of outpatient chemical dependency programs located throughout the city and out on Long Island.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Senators. My name is Bill Fusco. I'm the executive director of Dynamic Youth Community, which is a 43-year-old residential program with outpatient services in Brooklyn, but also servicing Long Island, Staten Island, upstate New York. We have 86 beds in Fallsburg, New York, 16 beds in Brooklyn, New York, and we're very glad to be here. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and thank you for this opportunity today. My name is Karen Carlini. I'm the Associate Director at Dynamic Youth Community, but I think also important to note that I'm the co-chair for the ASAP, Association of Substance Abuse Providers, Adolescent and Young Adult Committee for the state. So I'm here representing both. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Rahama Klatman. I'm the founder and executive director of MASK. MASK is Mothers and Fathers Aligned Saving Kids. I started the organization, we just started our 16th year. Senator Golden and Senator Felder have been a partner and supported MASK through many, many years. Thank you again. MASK, we have a helpline. We are a referral agency. We have support groups for parents. We are a school liaison. We do inpatient and outpatient referrals and placements for families that children do drugs, alcohol, eating disorders, gambling, and addiction.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Senators. My name is Jim Hollywood from Samaritan Village. Samaritan Village has a number of substance abuse treatment programs throughout New York State, 839 beds in total, two outpatient programs. Our residential programs focus on specialized services for young mothers and children, veteran services for men and women, and methadone to abstinence residential treatment program.
Great. Thank you very much. And if I could, first question, we'll get into a lot of the issues and insurance and stuff like that. My first question out of the box, and for the treatment providers and inpatients, what's the magic number of days that you think minimum is needed to, you come and have an opioid addict, heroin addict come in, they went through detox, they're there, how long do you need to keep them?
I'll take it. I'm in the middle, so, okay. We have both sides. I think it's a hard question to answer. I think that we provide long-term residential treatment. We provide long-term residential treatment of 1 year with an aftercare program with outpatient follow-up, because the people that come to our program, that's what they need.
Right.
That's what, you know, the level of care determination told us. I think that it's really important that the treatment provider is the person that's making that assessment. I know that there's pending legislation right now that would make that happen. But the idea of long-term residential, I would say, you know, at least, you know, 6 months in terms of the emerging adults, that 18 to 25-year-old, for what happens to them, what happens for the brain, and what happens, you know, scientifically to people, and then what happens to them emotionally for a family. Someone talked about before the time it takes for a family to heal. I think they need that time. That can't happen in a short period of time. So I can answer it, you know, from our perspective, although I think that there are shorter terms that might work in different circumstances.
And I...
Yeah.
Okay. So when you look at the research, any treatment over 90 days seem to be more effective. People stay engaged in treatment, whether it's outpatient treatment, residential treatment. So that you see the most positive effect when people stay engaged over 90 days. And so when we look at what is the magic number, it really also talks about the severity of the addiction, the co-occurring disorders that might accompany someone's addiction. Addiction is a biopsychosocial disease, and how far it impacts someone's development. Employment becomes an issue. Housing becomes an issue. So when you really try to boil down what is the essential elements of treatment, it's a holistic approach that looks at the mind, the body, and as well as the social connectedness of an individual. So there's no magic number. 90 days, it seems to be indicated in the research at minimum, and that goes for regardless of which level of care you're in. Right. The more contact people have in treatment, the better outcomes that are available.
Okay.
Yep. Just building on Mr. Hollywood's point, it's difficult to give you an exact number,
yeah,
especially if we're talking about legislation that's going to force the insurance companies to pay, mm-hmm, for what's being called medical necessity.
Right.
It's very difficult to hammer down a certain amount of days. If Dr. Kolodny was still in the room, he could tell you every patient is different, and the physician from Lutheran. So just from a detox point of view, you know, managed care companies are now telling the inpatient folks 3 to 5 days, and you're lucky to get five. They start doing discharge planning 24 hours in on a detox. You can't move a person over to an inpatient rehab while they're still tremulous and going through withdrawal. Then they want to route them out of the emergency room down to my level of care and the outpatient system of care, but folks are coming in, they're still in mild withdrawal symptoms. So I'd love to be able to sit here and give you an exact number, but Jim's point is right on the money. I mean, SAMHSA and NIDA and all the research has shown the longer a person's engaged in treatment, the better the outcomes. The juxtaposition of all of that is the insurance companies aren't allowing us to hold people in treatment that long anymore. You know, they're sending us fewer and fewer patients, and they want them out of treatment faster and faster.
Yes.
You know, from a parent point of view and from dealing with over 15,000 families, I have a whole different spin. My spin is that the first month when a kid gets put into a rehab or young adult or whatever, They're there against their will. They're not even listening. The second month, the 60 days, they're finally coming to accept that they need to be there. By 90 days, they're like, wow, I'm really here. The first 90 days are not treatment. It's just really a holding pen to get them to understand that's where they need to be, and then they start to listen. So if anyone thinks that the first 90 days they should be out of there, I mean, you're really wasting your money, because all of them that come out after 90 days, we have documented, do not do well. They need minimum, not a day less than 6 to 9 months, not a day less.
Karen, you mentioned level of care determination. Mm-hmm. Can you walk me through that process?
Well, right now, I know somebody mentioned before that OASIS is in the process of developing what would be called a locator, and that would be able to determine that level of care. Mm-hmm. But for an assessment, a counselor goes through a process of, you know, assessing the client to determine whether they need, you know, outpatient care, residential, and various other things. There could be mental health is considered, family support is considered. So there's all sorts of things that would determine where that person needs to be. Currently, obviously, we do that as treatment providers. What I think we fear is that with insurance coming in and what's happened already for people that we're working with the insurance companies, they're making that determination. And, excuse me, that's really what people aren't getting what they need, because the determination is being made by someone who's not a practitioner.
And that's our dilemma. Our dilemma is, and that's why the chairman asked the question, because in the three-prong approach that the task force is taking, the prevention, treatment, and additional prosecution, in a three-prong approach, the treatment end, began, at least I did, at a loss. And it was 19 years ago that I worked to set up the first drug treatment prison in this state's history, if not the nation's history. And that was a 90-day model. Willard was a 90-day model. And I agree with you. It's a very subjective issue, and it's very difficult to say 90 days. I mean, I can just, as you mentioned, the person in treatment, I can mention the inmate at Willard, that their motivation was if they get out of the program, they'll go to jail, a longer jail sentence. So they had some, at least, recognition, but 90 days is... But at the same token, the chairman asked this question, because we're going to have to ask the same question and maybe even tell the insurers what they're going to have to provide. And they're not going to like it, no matter what it is, 9 days, 9 minutes, 90 years. I mean, it's not going to matter from their perspective, except the question of cost. And we have to be sensitive to that, too, because everybody pays enormous insurance costs when we have to pay them in health insurance. And the fact is we need some guidance. I think that's just the beginnings are, we'd like it longer, we understand that, we get it. But the question is, how can we measure this stick so that the insurance companies will appreciate the fact that this is a more effective way to approach the problem?
Well, we're at an interesting point, because Senator Hannon's bill, 4623, the Access to Care bill, talks about all levels of care within OASIS, including residential, which insurance companies have never paid for before. That's always been either on the families or on the state, or it was funded in particular ways. So it is going to be an interesting debate as to whether or not the Access to Care bill is going to include all the levels of care as it should, or if the insurance companies are going to give an even greater pushback on covering only what's in the essential benefit package. So that's going to be a juggling act that the Senate is, you know, you're going to have to deal with. But we I think all agree, regardless of our focus or our level of care, that we agree with you. I mean, the Minnesota model that came out of treatment 30, 40 years ago was 30 days of rehab. The average length of stay in rehab now is under 16 days. That's all predicated on what managed care is willing to pay for, unless the families are willing to go into bankruptcy and foreclose on their home and take out second mortgages for their children. So when the insurance companies come back to the legislature and say, we don't want to pay for it because we're going to have to raise premiums, that's a weak argument because they raise premiums in New York State every year. You know, I'm also, you know, a small business owner, and I pay the premiums for my company. I can tell you that my premiums go up anywhere from 8 to 10% every year, regardless of the bills that you pass or don't pass. So that's something that really should not be the prevailing argument, whether or not it's good policy or not, because obviously, as some of the other folks have testified earlier, and the detective and the investigator said, if we invest a few dollars early on, the fiscal implications, the economic implications down the road, pay huge dividends.
Mr. Butchin, that's very well stated, and I certainly agree with your concept. We're just trying to hammer out the appropriate guidance to give the carriers in terms of this focus and what will be effective, what is necessarily the evidence coming from providers like yourselves who have to deal with these issues. It's certainly subjective. Understand it's different. One size doesn't fit all, but one policy will have to fit all in the state, in the sense of at least guidance. So any kind of guidance you can give us to give the carriers, we appreciate. And we're willing to make the statement that, yes, you need to provide this care. We did it with a lot of other things over the last few years. But the question becomes, how much?
Senator, could I just mention the fact that the amount of money is necessary really varies tremendously. For dynamic youth, it's under $30,000 a year. For 1 year in treatment, it's under $30,000. I can quote you programs that are 1 month for $30,000. So, I mean, to just look at it from a sense of time or length is not necessarily the best measuring stick. Honestly, I thought the measuring stick really should be, what the cost is. And the fact is that we've run studies number of times, throughout our years about short-term or what we call Band-Aid approaches. And we have a lot of kids who have been in 15 days, 20 days in Florida, 15 days here, 15 days there, all over the place for millions of dollars, millions of dollars. So if you shorten the length of treatment so short, whatever you're spending really is just throwing money away. So, you really need to think, not necessarily, you really need to think of what's going to be effective. We stand by the model of 9 months to a year for severe opiate addicts who are between the ages of 17 and 24. That we think that really is a model that, works and gives a young person a chance to really get their recovery in place for themselves.
And so,
Chairman, how many children, Mr. Fusco, have in that age, children, how many young adults in that age group is your agency dealt with, and in terms of experience level? What numbers are we talking about in terms of population you're familiar with?
Well, we deal exclusively with 17 to 24 year olds, and we have for the last 43 years. We're the first residential program exclusively for adolescents in New York State. Right now, we have 86 beds in Fallsburg, New York, which is near Monticello, New York. And we have 16 beds in Brooklyn, New York, and we have an aftercare of about 100, 125, who, after being in treatment, continue on with their families on sometimes starting on a day basis and then moving on to night basis and moving on from there. So in total, we probably serve somewhere around 175 to 200 families a year.
What's the drug of choice?
Absolutely. I just wrote it down. We're running right now 30% prescription drugs, 63% heroin.
And how How's that changed over the last 2 years, 3 years?
I have that number, too.
I'm doing pretty good.
In 2011, it was 47% prescription drugs, 27% heroin. Going back to 2007, it was 13% prescription drugs, 21% heroin. So we went from a little bit over 40% in 07, in 2011, 73%, 93% today.
And wow. How has it changed the getting these drugs over the last 3 years? By purchasing illegally, homes,
I don't have
prescription,
that
doctor shopping?
I think there's various reasons. You know, some of the kids in the program are here today, so I think they're probably the best to ask. And we, believe me, we ask them a lot. But there's different answers. Some, like one of the kids that stood up earlier today, from the medicine cabinet. Some from a party. You know, some even from an injury. Maybe they were an athlete and there was an injury and it started that way. But their stories aren't very different than most of the stories you've heard in the last few years in terms of how people start, especially young people.
Can I ask that young man to stand up again? We're going to pick on you today. How many pounds do you weigh?
How much do I weigh? 165.
165 pounds. How many times does it take before he's addicted to heroin? How many times before he takes a hit on heroin? Before he goes to the actual crushing, snorting, taking that pill? How long does it take him to get addicted?
That's a
How long did it take
call.
You to get addicted?
I can't give that call. I mean, I'm going to say the average amount of opiate addiction in the program is going anywhere from 1 year to about 6 years. So, you know, and the level of addiction, you know, I mean, Senator, let's start with the fact that, you know, a lot of our kids like to get high, unfortunately. And As these drugs vary and modify and go back and forth,
I think
there is an underlying fact of, you know, working with families, of trying to help people stay clean and sober is a really, really, really important test.
What I was trying to point out, I think a young man of this weight, 3 to 4 to 5 hits of heroin is enough to addict him. That's what I was trying to point out. You had your hand up back there, real quick. Yeah.
Thank you.
My name's Anthony Alvarenga. Speak up.
I said my name's Anthony Alvarenga. I'm currently in treatment, and it takes three to five days of continuous use to get a habit.
Thank you.
Thank
you very much. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Mr. Fusco.
So what I guess, you know, when talking about the level of care, and honestly, it was really the first thing that came to mind for me. I think it is essential that we think in terms of length of stay. It can be not necessarily an intensive medical model. I don't think that's necessary. So there are ways of making cost, inside the peer situation reasonable, but I think that the length of stay in a supportive environment is very, very critical to a lot of young people getting a chance of getting their lives back.
And if I could, just back to the point of insurance, you know, it's sort of coming at the worst time, I think, that healthcare reform as the opiate addiction has risen, because, like the gentleman had pointed out, 3 to 5 uses and you're addicted. The prescription drug epidemic really sort of heightened or fueled the addiction because it was pharmaceutical grade. It was always Oxycontin is an Oxycontin, right? And so a bag of heroin varies considerably, and that's the concern about heroin overdose. When people transition, is the dosing is not regulated or controlled. Mm-hmm. So what happens with, and I think is that the prescription pill epidemic, which might be waning because of iStop or other trends that might be happening, but the heroin epidemic is the thing that I most worry about is because there's going to be an inconsistency in the supply and the quality, which would only fuel other behaviors, which get folks in trouble. So back to it, the impact of the health care is that this is a lifelong chronic progressive disease, which people can recover from. The length of time in treatment is an impacting element in terms of people's overall recovery. So to really think about the fact that we have such increasing numbers of young adults who have a chronic progressive relapsing disease starting at 16, 17, 18, and 19, now that's going to project over their lifetime. That's going to not just affect us in this budget year or this funding year, but you're going to talk about this is going to be a protracted experience for us as a state and a community.
Thank you very much. And so let's just ask, I'm asking about the insurance aspect of this. So now, can you tell me how your patients are paid for and what's the process? They come in, you argue with the insurance company for a couple days, and then you finally get coverage, or how does that work?
I think one thing that's important to note is some of us aren't necessarily collecting insurance. Remember, mm-hmm. we provide residential services.
Yeah.
So
however it is, yeah.
How that's happened up until now is through state aid mm-hmm. and other third-party funding that we've tried to secure to make that happen. The process for the insurance companies varies from one insurance company
right.
to the other, mm-hmm. and it depends. It is never close enough mm-hmm. to what the cost should be mm-hmm. or what the prescribed visit should be.
Right.
And I think Gary probably should talk about this a little bit more in terms of what happens for you in the process, if you don't mind.
No, it's fine.
Well, we're in a unique position because we're a private program. Mm-hmm. We receive no funding. So we're dealing with managed care companies every single day mm-hmm. for everything that we do, and we have been for 20 years. So we've seen the genesis of managed care since its inception. Theoretically, as an outpatient system of care, the managed care companies would want to use my level of care as opposed to residential or inpatient or even detox. But even at the outpatient system, it's an argument. So we have clinicians, physicians, psychologists who do full-blown evaluations on patients, and when we determine that someone needs a higher level of care, there's no better expert in the room at that moment than us. We're on the phone with the insurance company, and it could be a managed care company based in Salt Lake City or Philadelphia or anywhere around the country, and we're arguing with a nurse who hasn't seen the patient. We're arguing with a physician who, by the way, is not an addiction psychiatrist. It could be a podiatrist who's telling us what level of care, try to hold the patient in your outpatient system, or we'll give you a 1 to 2 days of detox, and then we want them back into your ambulatory detox to manage the mild to moderate withdrawal symptoms. So we're saying to them, so you know that you're going to send me back a patient who's going to be uncomfortable. You're not going to allow them to complete their course of care, and I'm supposed to pick up the pieces. That's if they even come back into my door, as opposed to going to cop on the streets again because they're horribly uncomfortable. So we deal with this issue every single day. We offer the intensive outpatient level of care also. And I know that you've probably heard testimony from around the state about how difficult it is to get people into detox or rehab. We can't even get them authorized for the intensive outpatient level of care. They just want them in standard outpatient, and then the old argument, let them go to a 12-step program.
Give me an example of the difference between regular outpatient and intensive outpatient. What kind of services?
Intensive outpatient is should be at least 9 hours a week or more. We offer it 5 days a week, 3 hours a day, so it could be up to 15
okay.
hours.
Right.
And that's theoretically a step down between the rehab and standard outpatient. Standard outpatient is psychotherapy, 45-minute session once a week, a couple of groups, 60 minutes, 90 minutes once or twice a week.
Right.
So it's a step down in the continuum. So we're offering that buffer level between residential and outpatient, and that was created back in the early 90s by managed care because they didn't want to pay for the residential treatment component. So it became a level of care that the managed care companies created.
Regarding the now, you take Medicaid or any facilities?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. On a fee-for-service basis.
Any
in the outpatients,
In
the outpatients, yeah. Not in the residential treatment program.
Any trouble with coverage of that, arguing about the...
In the Medicaid or...
Yeah, Medicaid, I'm sorry, Medicaid, yeah.
Defer to you.
No, not necessarily. I mean, yeah. there are problems with accessing treatment. If someone is on Medicaid and they come into our program,
right.
We're able to bill for that. The issues with Medicaid have nothing to do with people being denied treatment as a result of being on Medicaid.
Except,
I think that's what you're asking.
Except the concern is now we're going to this so substance abusing population had a carve out which is no longer going to exist,
right.
And as we move to managed care, manage Medicaid, mm-hmm. then we're going to be subject.
We'll
to
experience the same problems with managed care.
It is
important to say
insurance.
That with straight Medicaid. We don't have the kinds of problems that we anticipate with managed care that Gary's program already experiences.
Yeah. That was my question. So you're not experiencing yet, but you
We're
may.
We're not yet, but we will. All right. I think we anticipate the same thing that everybody else is experiencing now.
I mean, obviously, one of the big questions is Obamacare comes in, and addiction services are supposed to be one of the 10 areas covered. How much and what limits are going to be put in place of that is going to be a question.
Right. We're very concerned about that. We're very concerned about co-pays. We're mm-hmm. very concerned, you know, about limits on length of stay and visits.
We would also like to say that the block grant certainly has been a major part of the funding for the residential programs, and we would like to see that continued. And, of course, the state aid to localities are really the umbrella. That's really the safety net.
We don't do that here in the city.
Yeah, I think that that's important to say because while I say that currently we don't have issues with Medicaid in terms of the treatment, we would never be able to support our program solely on Medicaid.
Yeah.
So, and especially our program and maybe some others with younger people, many aren't on Medicaid anyway, so we have about 40% of our population are on Medicaid in the outpatient program, and that's
and the other 60%?
Private insurance that we're really not able to access enough, you know, to support the program. Some are getting on now. There is a little bit of a difference with Obamacare, but the private insurance, we haven't been able to access private insurance at this point.
Samaritan James, your situation?
So the residential treatment programs are funded, as Billy pointed out, by net deficit funding, which is state aid comes with the block grant. That's a part of the match. The other part is local DSS supports through congregate care level 2 funding from both the county or the city in that regard. And back to the number for us, it's a little bit over $20,000 a year per bed, and it's built basically on an economy of scale, and the programs are bigger than even the research might support. So when we look at not just the length of time, also want to look at the size of programs, want to look at how effective programs could be, especially in light of the residential redesign, which is occurring right now, and you know there's. Hope that the residential redesign would look at incorporating insurance money alongside of state aid and congregate care support.
Is there anybody on that? Is there a task force on that? How is that being created?
It's a task force led by OASIS and a number of providers.
Are you on that?
Samaritan Village is represented on it, yes. Okay.
Yes, TCA, regional TCA, and OASIS co-chair the group. Pretty wide.
And you're comfortable the way it's moving?
We're encouraged by it. and the big thing...
That's a good word.
Yes, we are encouraged. The fact that residential treatment is being is looked to be being preserved as part of the treatment continuum. For the severely addicted, removing people from their social environment, bringing them to a much more therapeutic environment, has benefits, and as other panel members have pointed out, you know, the length of time, 6 to 9 months, seems to be much more impactful, especially for a younger population. For folks that we serve who are adults, you know, the length of stay, again, anything over 90 days is helpful. The worry that we have is that we become we become like an inpatient rehab, which is more of a 30-day model. You know, that will get pressed to drop below even the 90-day that we're hoping to at least get out of the residential redesign, because that for us is a bare minimum. You know, that's sort of the minimum dose, effective dose of residential services for severely addicted individuals.
I'm not sure that we can do this, but I'm going to ask my chairman. I guess we'll have to sit down and discuss this. I don't know if there's any way that we can support some of your recommendations from this task force, and I guess we'd have to look to the committee chairman, to the chair members as, you know, which ones we could support, if in fact we could support.
Certainly. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience? Yeah. Count, yeah.
Hi, I'm Ken Foster from Serendipity One. I just have two things to say real quick.
Louder and slower.
Sorry, I talk fast. Two things to say. One, I want to reiterate how hard it is.
Now it's working. How hard it is to get into detox. I got turned away from 5 different hospitals in Long Island and was told to go home and don't use. And that's not happening for a person who has an addiction problem.
I'm not going to pick on my friends from Long Island, but Lutheran Medical were taken like that. Go ahead.
I've been to quite a few. The other thing, as far as how long you need to be in a rehab or a long-term treatment facility, the longer the better. For me, that's why I'm in a one-year program, because I know I need it. But for a lot of people I know out in Long Island that have jobs and, you know, actually work and just aren't homeless, you can't just take a year off from work. So having the 28-day programs or the sort of the Band-Aid programs, as I said, still available is definitely necessary too. So you want to keep that in mind, not to try to cut them out. But the long term is definitely vital too.
Thank you.
If
I could just add to that, and I appreciate you bringing up that point. I think we need to have look at all levels of care as being effective, right? And we look at what is needed for that individual. And clearly, people who are employed and need to go back to supporting a household and themselves, and they have those means, they might actually be indicated in terms of their social connectedness and that they could return to the community. But back to what Gary said, is then maybe it's an intensive outpatient program, one that could be intensified in services that support working folks, because it's the aftercare. It's not the, you know, the detox works, but it's really the aftercare that follows up around the detox that will ensure that it sticks. So it really is, you know, there's no one model that works. If it was, we would have maybe discovered it and not have a panel today. But it's really going to be, I think, a broad-based approach, looking at varying levels of care, medication-assisted treatment incorporated in that, naloxone incorporated even in treatment provider programs, providing education to our patients and our family members. So I support what was said.
Narcotics, obviously, is a terrible disease, and whether it's Oxycontin or hydrocodone or heroin, I don't know. There might be one or two that, and any of you that progressed quickly enough to using a needle in the crowd that would want to. Why don't you just, anybody want to talk about it? How long it took them? Go ahead, right here. No, it's okay. Just give it a moment. They'll be on. No, keep it up. Keep it up. It'll be on. It's on now. Go ahead. It'll be on in a minute.
I did Oxycontin for like 6 years, I would say, you know, lower, higher?
No, higher.
Okay, I did Oxycontin for about 6 years, and once I progressed to heroin, I ended up shooting heroin within a month. And when you learn on the streets how much better it is from everybody, it just the talk about it, you know, nobody could resist it. And once you start doing it, there's really no other way of, like, you know, putting it down, because once you get that sensation, I guess you could say, it never changes, you know.
And so, you're constantly chasing the high that never comes back,
right? Yeah, you could say that. I guess it's more of like the fact that you think you need something that you don't actually need, you know what I mean? And until you are able to get away from it, which is what the long-term treatment centers are able to do for you, you know what I mean, is to put you away from your environment and away from, like, being on the streets and stuff.
How did you get the help that you got?
How did I get
there? How'd you get here? How'd you get to the...
I actually got lucky because I live on Long Island, and it was a lot harder for me to get to a program that was upstate. So my mom actually knew through a psychiatrist, was able to get me into Dynamite.
Okay. And how long have you been in the program now?
Almost 13 months.
13 months. And yes. How are you progressing?
I'm doing fine. I haven't used or picked up anything in 13 months. I actually just came down from the upstate facility, so now I'm in the outpatient facility down here. And, you know, it's working. It works very well. The people at Dynamite are just fantastic with the way that the program works, you know, and that's really...
Give it to the mic to the young man with the white suit on. Right back there. Right there. You had your hand up? Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Okay, whoever wanted to speak back there, go ahead.
Would you mind if I...
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Since I have it, I figured I might as well anyway.
Closer to you.
Okay. This is good? Okay. My name is Khaled Hussein. I'm actually a member of Dynamite Youth right now. I'm actually a member of the Bay Ridge community as well. I have been for about 18 years. And I relate a lot of things that were said here today. Particularly, I mean, just the way prescription pills have kind of taken over my life and the life of so many of my close friends. Linda Sarsour that was speaking earlier, she mentioned... a few deaths in the Bay Ridge community over the past.
How'd you get to prescription drugs?
My first time, I got it prescribed by a doctor. I was about 19 years old. I had gotten in a car accident. I was having acute knee pain, and he prescribed me 90-10 milligram oxycodone pills without any instruction how to use them. Just follow the bottle, and the bottle said take every 4 hours or take as needed. But that's how I got my hands on them initially. I mean, after I became addicted, me and my friends, we started taking them out of our parents' medicine cabinets, just any way we could get our hands on them, doctor shopping, just everything. It just followed. It just became about any way we could get them. And it eventually progressed to heroin. Once I found out about heroin after doing it for the first time, just after experiencing that initial high, there was just no going back to that. It was
using a needle?
Yes, eventually I did.
And
yes.
How many of your friends were using went to needles?
It's hard to give you a number. But almost every single person that I used a prescription pill with, that I ever used an opiate with, eventually ended up doing heroin.
And how many would you say that was?
Maybe about 20, 25 of my close friends.
And you all hung out in the same areas in Bay Ridge?
Yes.
Okay.
Two of them, actually, the most recent ones, the one that just left the hospital in a coma, and the one that just passed away. I had about six personal friends die this past year in Bay Ridge alone. Just off overdoses of heroin.
What woke you up? What brought you to realization that you needed this program or you were going to die?
It's hard to word this, but I was lucky enough to go to the point of abuse, like abusing myself to the point where I realized I needed help. I was sitting in a jail cell on Rikers Island at the bottom, at my rock bottom, when I realized I needed help. And I was lucky enough to get referred to Dynamite, actually. I was lucky enough to get referred to this program where, I mean, just the model's so much more intense. It's not just, like, about taking the drugs away because there's so much underlying the drugs. You take that out of the picture, but there was just so much more damage that I had done to myself, like, emotionally, behavioral-wise, and just there's so much underlying that drug use that needed attention that I was able to get the help.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do me a favor. Anybody else wants to briefly, and you don't have to share, I know honesty is a big part of this program. We just want to see the importance of the program and try to how the program has helped you.
My name is Joe. I'm 24 years old. I'm currently with Dynamite Youth Center. I have been to countless detoxes, countless 30-day rehab, 60-day rehabs.
I'm sorry.
I'm 24 years old.
Go ahead.
My addiction started, I was 21 years old, I was injured in an accident, I was prescribed OxyContin, within a month, I was, you know, addicted, bad, 6 months later, I was IV and heroin, which led me to, you know, in between that time period, I was in countless detoxes, I couldn't even tell you. I was a resident from Staten Island, countless detoxes. Landed me in my first rehabilitation center in Florida. I was there for 30 days, halfway house. My parents had continued to send me from one place to another. I became homeless a dozen times, you know, in three different states, bounced around, all over the place. I came to my realization 18 months ago, walking to Dynamite. I was in a shelter in Staten Island. I was sitting on a cot. I lost everything. I come from an upper middle class family, grew up good high schools, you know. Sitting on a cot, homeless, in the street back in Staten Island, and had realized that I didn't want to live this way anymore. I was going to die. I had overdosed 4 times. I almost lost my left arm. And I'm 18 months sober now due to long-term treatment.
Very good. Quick question. I'm sorry. Describe the first time you tried heroin. So you're injured. You tried oxycodone, opioids. The first, could you say, well, it's a lot cheaper? Did someone say, hey, we can get this thing for the same high? Yeah, or how did that work?
Well, for oxycodone, OxyContin, at this point, at $25 a pill, I mean, my habit had increased to $200 a day. Mm-hmm. Now, I have been, you know, I was let go. I worked for a family business. I was let go because of stealing and other, you know, things I was doing. So, I mean, to support that was, you know, it was astronomical, which had led me to, you know, financially cheaper, you know, which had brought me into, you know, dealing with pills. You're dealing with a middle class group of people, growing up in Staten Island, doing heroin and all the drugs that I had explored. It led me into bad places, you know, bad areas, you know. So,
thank you.
If there's just two more, if we can, because I tell me, and do me a favor again, just be brief and help us out where you think you can give us a description of how we can be more helpful as a task force to get more help for you and for your family.
My name's Leanne. I'm 25, and I'm part of Dynamic Youth. And you were speaking before about, like, you were wondering if marijuana was a gateway drug, and that's exactly how I started. I started drinking and using marijuana, and also with Vicodin. That was the opening for the opiate addiction for me.
Did you know Vicodin was heroin?
No, not at the time. At the time, I didn't have an injury. I was just experimenting, and a lot of, I guess it was peer pressure we're taking. And once I did that, it just led on and on. It was more of like a tolerance thing for me, where that wasn't enough, so I moved to OxyContin and then eventually to heroin. And for
was
me,
that a financial thing for you, too, because you realized
absolutely.
OxyContin was so much more expensive and...
Absolutely. I mean, it was a tolerance thing where I would have to, at the time I felt like I needed it or else I would, you know, withdraw. And so it was a financial thing. It was a tolerance thing. And I've been to countless 28-day rehabs, 30-day rehabs where I would get out and I would use right away because I felt very awkward in society. I was just taken out for a little bit just to pretty much for me, I feel like it's just getting the drugs out of your system at that point where someone said that, you know, my mother wanted me to go in, and I was still battling, like, I don't need to be here. This is not me. I'm not like them, you know. So with the long-term treatment, I feel like there's no other way than to go away for a while, to get out of, see, I'm from Staten Island. I needed to get away from there. And also, it's long enough for me to feel, like, comfortable without using, because I've been using for so long, that I can interact with other people. I can learn how to, like... just be in life without you know using after so long. And then coming down, also the big part for me was maintaining it, going to, you know, the outpatient part, you know, 5 days a week, and adjusting back in, because that's where I mess up, where I feel uncomfortable and stuff like that, you know what I mean? So for me to get into Dynamite, it took an arrest, which honestly was it was a bad time in my life, but it was the best thing that ever happened to me because it got me in, it opened my eyes, and I feel like that's a big thing for a lot of people. Sometimes that is the case, and unfortunately that was my case, but it was the best thing, you know, that ever happened to
when
me.
When you were arrested, what was the next step?
The next step was they already knew my history of me trying to get clean before, going into rehabs and not working, and they said, you know, you can't just do a 28-day. It doesn't work for you. So they said, you know, you should go away for a while, and they told me to go away for 9 months, and in Dynamite, you know, my 9 months went up, and I was like, I'm not leaving. This is great. You know what I mean? I'm not going to leave this place that just saved my life, and I'm going to continue with it. So that's what I did at that point. But I don't, you know, I could have gotten to a worse place if I didn't get stopped there. You know, I feel like it was like a sign or something. That's how I look at it. So.
Thank you.
We're coming back to you guys in a minute. Any other better you want to share?
One more.
Okay, we're going to get back to the panel shortly. If there's anything that you think we left out that we should be focused on, please give us right after this person gives us some direction. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Patrick. I'm 21 years old, and I am a member of Dynamic Youth Community. And the thing I wanted to stress the most was about how the insurance companies treated me, because Dynamic Youth Community is my 17th program. I started at the age of 16 with the opiates. I was in a lacrosse accident, and I shattered my thumb. And the doctor, he prescribed me oxycodone, and he said I had the good stuff, which I thought was absolutely terrible. Didn't explain to me how addictive the substance was or anything about that. I mean, I don't even know if he was educated. But the way it worked with the insurance companies was go to a 30-day program, and then they would say, no, you need 2 weeks, even though it was against what the what the rehabilitation center had said. So I kept going back and forth through that, and it ended up being a disaster. I went from program to program to program until finding the long-term treatment program, which showed how to, along with the addiction, how to rebuild your life skills, which someone who became an addict as young as I did not achieve. So now, aside from addiction and learning how to stay sober and learning how to have fun again in recovery, now I know how to hold a job, and I just wanted to know if there's any steps that you guys are taking in order to go against what the insurance companies are saying, or with the funding, how it's going to work towards long-term treatment, because obviously the success rates with that, with extreme cases like me and some of my peers that are here, what's going to happen? What are the steps that are going to be taken to go forth with that?
Well, I believe I'm going to let the chairman speak to that in a moment, but I'm going to tell you, the more I listen here and the more I see you stand up and tell me how many times you've gone to detox, how many times you've been in programs, how long it took you to finally get it, and to get the help that you needed. It looks like it was extremely more costly. Had we made the investment up front and put you into a program, that would have fixed you and put you on the right track in the first place. I think it was much more costly, the path that many of you have taken, unfortunately. But I guess that comes to the professionals and understanding and keeping those different people that are affected in the program. I guess then how long that program lasts is, and you guys have to make the diagnosis as to what that deadline and what that timeline is. So I do believe that the more we look at this, the more we hear, the smarter thing to do here is to make the investment up front and sooner. Of course, having to deal with our insurance companies and Medicaid and the redesign team here in the state of New York, as well as the Obama Healthcare, is going to be a lot more difficult to do than what I've just said. Chairman?
Yes, Senator Golden, I couldn't agree more. And we hear this over and over again. And whether it's four rehabs or 17, or it really is, the system is not the most efficient that it can be in terms of tax dollars and helping young individuals such as yourselves to go through recovery. And an important thing, Patrick said, learning the life skills that you weren't able to the first time. And that's exactly what we're going to look to do as part of this task force. When we issue our report, which is going to come out June 1st, you can look at it, and I can promise you, young people, that what you said here today is going to be part of that report. And we've learned a lot from you. I appreciate it very much. Our panelists, if you'd like to, any final comments or thoughts? Or
Mr. Fusco, I know you got a word or two.
That's why I'm going to go first. You have a Herculean task in front of you. There are so many moving parts to this problem, from the physicians who spoke earlier about the medicines that are available to us versus the stigma, to the woman who spoke earlier about the debacle in sober homes, to the Mason-Dixon line between the Medicaid and managed Medicaid versus pure commercial insurance plans, and what the juggling act that all of us sitting here have to deal with every single day. The system that exists and the variety of programs that we all offer does have remarkable outcomes when the people who have tried 17 times or 16 times try the 17th time to get in. That should never be the case. What I'm imploring you to do is really take a good hard look at medical necessity, regardless of whether it's 4623 or any other version of it. Because if this panel, if we were replaced by the medical directors of the managed care companies operating in New York State, they would convince you that they've got fantastic policies that dictate medical necessity for the treatment of addictions. Mm-hmm. The problem is they're all different. They're all proprietary, and they're not shared with their own provider network unless you foil them. Mm-hmm. If New York State puts on the books a definition of medical necessity that they all have to be held accountable to, mm-hmm. then what we were talking about earlier would bear better results.
We are going to. That's one thing I'm pretty certain is going to come out of this in terms of insurance. When I've talked to 10 different insurance companies with 10 different definitions of medical necessity, and all of them are trying to sneak their way out of coverage, basically, we're going to put their feet to the fire, I can promise you, and thank you for those comments.
Well, and you mentioned this earlier, Mr. Butchin, that you pay them now or pay them later. I mean, that's the kind of issue that you have a problem that can be dealt with financially appropriately and significantly now, or we pay more because the problem wasn't resolved.
Last week I attended the National Prescription Drug Abuse Conference in Atlanta, and for 3 days they threw all sorts of statistics to us, many of which we know, and we know in New York, it's happening all over the country. But one of the things they talked about was just in this last decade, 125,000 people died from overdose from just hydrocodone. And that number was just compelling to me. For all I know and for all I hear, that number was compelling because they talked about if we did a moment of silence for those 125,000 people, it would take 3 months to accomplish. And that it's also twice as many people who died in Vietnam. And when we think about the spillover from Vietnam and everything that's happened as a result of what people suffered in Vietnam, where are we going to be as this problem continues? The thing that made me feel good, or what I walked away with, was in every workshop, every plenary, every session that I attended, everyone had the same message about collaboration. And I think we're finally there. And I can't thank this panel enough and what's happened, you know, in the New York Senate in terms of pulling us all together as a group and every component of it, because if without collaboration, this problem's not going to get solved. And as Gary said, there's so many different pieces, and we're trying to balance that as well. I mean, it's like a moving machine every day. It changes, and what we have to do. So I think what we're asking is that you be sensitive to the fact that we don't want to over-regulate. You know, we don't want to look at, you know, when we talk about law enforcement, we want to make sure that those that need treatment get treatment. Those that need, you know, so we look at that. When we look at prevention, we look at education. We look at what we do have to mandate people to do, but that you lean on the treatment community to help provide that because of our experience. Like Bill said, we're 43 years. You know, I'm with the program 42. Bill's with from day one. So we've certainly seen it all. Well, no, we haven't seen it all, unfortunately. This was a lot for us, more than we had seen in the 30 years in the past. So we have work to do, but again, I thank you and appreciate the effort.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you very much. Yes. Thank you, Karen.
I'd like to touch on the issue of family. The families, once the young adult is put into rehab, the families must get educated in whatever they're learning in the rehab, so when the kid gets out, the family recognizes the red flags, et cetera. But prevention is the number one message that I'd like to leave today with, is that a regular parent, after interviewing 15,000 parents, I interview every family myself, and the one thing for sure, they don't know the connection between their medicine cabinet and heroin, opiates, or anything. So ads, user-friendly to a regular mom and dad that are not in the drug community is very important. And also prevention in the elementary schools to make it more user-friendly so that it gets translated from their point of view, not from adults and us that are sitting at the tables.
Thank you very, very much for today.
Thank you.
And all I could do is reiterate the what the panel said here is really it's a broad-based approach that will soften or try to solve this problem from education, from prevention, from the use of naloxone and first for emergency responders, for the family members, for those suffering with addiction as well. And really to look at the need for a spectrum of treatment intervention. Community-based care, community-based detox does work and is effective. Medication-assisted treatments are important. They mentioned it earlier, the first panel, methadone and Suboxone and Vivitrol and the like, finding the right mix for people, and an important thing to recognize the need for the severely addicted is the long-term residential treatment does work, has been an effective part of the New York State model in treating addictions. You know, over the past 30 years, starting with the DTAP and TASC initiatives, have solved a great problem of court diversion, the need for court diversion, and so it had served the state well when that was a crisis, when crack cocaine was a crisis, when jails were overcrowded, and I think it will serve a great role moving forward during this epidemic, is to be able to provide long-term care for those who need it. As the members of this audience sort of testified to. So,
thank you, Mr.
Senator. Could I just say back in 2007, Jerry Kassar.
You've got to get all this. You need to change the tape, and then you can.
2 minutes.
I got 2 minutes. It's simple.
No.
2 minutes to wait. We have a couple kids that can sing back here.
Well, I got to tell you, I got to give all these kids credit. I tell you, you guys are the lucky ones, right? How many kids don't make it? How many people? How many more wakes are we going to go to? How many more families' hearts are going to be broken? So God has been good and gifted you, and I thank you. And I thank all the different providers here today for the great work that they've been able to do to return these young men and women back to their families and to the society, and to allow them to go forward and to be productive. So we thank you, too, this panel, for all this good work that they've done. And they continue. Give this panel a round of applause and the previous panel.
I did want to mention, Senator, that back in 2007, Jerry Kassar and myself, under your leadership, went to Albany and talked about the tremendous amount, the tremendous percentage of prescription drug young people that were coming into our program. And at that time, we were told that nobody can tell the AMA what to do. And we've been on a mission ever since, trying to say, as we saw what was happening in our communities. And I do have to say, I think one of the things that we try to tell the young people here who don't necessarily come forward all the time, that they're contributing, that it's time that people come out and say what's going on, and that's part of the solution. And I think they see themselves as part of the solution now. Thank you.
For those that testified here today, I just want to say all of my colleagues here today that came in from across the state take this very, very seriously. And they're all approachable. So if there's something that you did not get out that you're either you wanted to testify or if you're one in the audience, please contact any one of us. The chairman will make sure that it's taken into consideration. Any of the thoughts that you have that may not have been brought up that you're walking out the door and says, gee, I should have said this. Please, we're all approachable.
Thank you. Mr. Vice Chairman, would you have final comments?
There was one lady that asked to speak, and in the blue, did you rose your hand a couple of times. I don't know if anybody saw you behind the post here, but I did, so I...
I practice in Bay Ridge. I'm a medical provider. I know what's being done to look into
Hello. Not a very good public speaker, but I know what's being done to in terms of monitoring pharmacies and physicians, and we're aware of this. What is being done to get the drugs off the streets? If we had no heroin, would we be even having this discussion today?
I don't know if you were here when the prior panel was here.
I was.
But Attorney McGoldrick and a detective went through a laundry list of items that are ongoing, deficiencies not necessarily in the punishment statutes, but in the investigative areas, and that we are going to be working in terms of helping eliminate a lot of the supply that the taxpayers actually are paying for in putting it out into the streets. Not the taxpayers, but other unscrupulous individuals are putting it out into the street, and I think that's certainly something. And our mission, stated by Chairman Boyle, is threefold. It's prevention first, treatment second, and prosecution third. And that's an approach, a lot of moving parts, as Gary said, but that's what we're focused on.
Do you feel that it's working?
Obviously, if it was, we wouldn't be here. I think much of it's working. When I see our young people in the center here standing up and saying they're drug-free, that gives us hope. And that's it can be done if it's done the correct way. And that's what you all have given us evidence about today. But as our law enforcement officers have given us evidence today, that it's a problem, a lot more resources need to be deployed to defeat it that end. Again, it's many moving parts to this very important problem. And thank you, from my personal standpoint, for adding to the discussion in a very, very great way. Thank you.
And I, too, like to thank you, Vice Chairman Nozzolio and Senator Golden. Thank you for hosting this forum. Thank you to our panelists and each of the panelists, and to the young people here. Best of luck in your recovery. We'll be praying for you. And thank you for everything. We got a lot of good ideas out. And as Senator Golden said, if you think of something you didn't remember to say now, contact our office, because we got until June 1st. Thank you very much.